Good morning, everybody. We convene this hearing to find out what the administration has done to implement the president's repeated promise to conduct a page-by-page, line-by-line review of the federal budget and what more can be done. The aim of such a review is to eliminate unnecessary, duplicative, or wasteful government programs and to cut costs and create new efficiencies. The urgent need for such a review, of course, is obvious. Under the Obama administration, federal spending has increased by more than 20% a year, or more than $600 billion per year. Under the Obama administration, the size of the cumulative federal debt has increased about 40%, from $10.6 trillion to $14.8 trillion, and, frankly, it continues to climb. President Obama promised a fresh, in-depth, and exhaustive review of the federal budget. What measurable actions have been taken, and of course, what are the results? Unfortunately, the Office of Management and Budget, the agency in charge of the line-by-line review, declined to provide a witness today to testify to answer these questions. It is curious that OMB claims that it has no witnesses to testify on this issue when Jack Lew, the OMB director, discussed line-by-line review in February 2011 with testimony before the House Budget Committee. And Jeffrey Zeitz, the OMB's chief performance officer and deputy director for management, is the official that President Obama linked to conducting the review. This line-by-line review has supposedly been a top priority for the Obama administration for the last 3 years. With that understanding, one would think there are things they would want to talk about and they'd come today and testify. Unfortunately, they did not. This is not the first time during this Congress that OMB has refused to send a witness. Jeffrey Zeitz, the Deputy Director for Management, failed to appear at the June 24th hearing on Solyndra. And OMB is the only agency to require a subpoena from this committee because of its refusal to provide documents. One can't help but wonder whether OMB's refusal to provide a witness is because they don't have anything to say or because they are upset that their stonewalling tactics in the Solyndra investigation have not worked. In a letter to the committee, OMB noted that a major accomplishment of its efforts to comb through the budget line by line has been the identification of innumerable so-called terminations, reductions, and savings, end quote. However, as Clint Brass, a Congressional Research Service analysis analyst, has confirmed, the Obama administration's issue of a volume like the Termination Reductions and Savings, or TRS, as was called, document among a president's budget proposal was not new. Generally speaking, he said, he continues, these kinds of budget documents have been produced by presidents dating back to President Ronald Reagan, if not before, in a variety of configurations. The TRS document is by nature an adequate tool for achieving the ambitious goal of line-by-line review. Aside from being non-exhaustive, there is no clear one-to-one correspondence between the line-by-line review and the proposals included in the TRS document. In any event, the proposed $17 billion to be saved by the way of 121 cuts of restructuring to discretionary programs and mandatory spending in the fiscal year 2000 budget is not that impressive. In comparison, in fiscal year 2009, the Bush administration proposed double that amount, or $34 billion. Ultimately, the Obama administration's proposed $17 billion in cuts, of which $11.5 billion was on the discretionary side of the budget, resulted in only $6.9 billion in cuts approved by Congress. Now, complicating things further, as Mr. Brass pointed out, quote, typically these kinds of TRS documents have not been followed by subsequent publications that showed in detail the extent to which Congress adopted the President's recommendations, end quote. Thus, there is little proof of what the actual savings are. Also, it is not unusual for the budget authority behind these proposed terminations, reductions, and savings to simply be transferred or consolidated elsewhere. more than offsetting any administration's efforts towards real progress in restoring fiscal discipline is the inconvenient fact that despite the cuts it has proposed thus far, federal spending is soaring and the budget deficit is exceeding over $1 trillion a year. As a share of gross domestic product, spending grew from 18% in 2001 to 24% in 2011, while debt held by the public jumped from 33% to 67%. The Congressional Budget Office projects that without reform, spending and debt will continue to rise for decades to come. No $17 billion or even $50 billion for that matter worth of proposed termination reduction in the savings in any given year is enough to reverse this harmful trend. We need to find out the actual results from this review, build on ongoing initiatives, pursue new approaches to find more cuts and save more money. Today's hearing can be a good start to help us deal more effectively with the enormous challenges of getting federal spending under control. And the committee, I'd ask unanimous consent that a majority supplemental memo and attached letter from OMB be introduced into the record.
Let me review it, and then I'll let you know.
All right. The gentlelady said they'll review. And with that, I recognize the distinguished lady from Colorado for her opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. As we embark on this, quote, line-by-line budget review hearing series, I want to urge my colleagues to keep the important passages of the Constitution in mind, which I'm sure they all remember since we read the Constitution at the beginning of this session of Congress. Quote, no money shall be drawn from the Treasury, but in consequence of appropriations made by law, and, quote, the Congress shall have the power to lay and collect taxes and to borrow money on the credit of the United States. These provisions of Article 1, Clause 8 of our Constitution grant the power of the purse to Congress. That means that legislation to authorize the nation's fiscal path begins in Congress, and Congress is the steward of our nation's budget. I note these provisions because I believe if my colleagues on the other side of the aisle are going to use today's hearing as a forum to express concern about whether the President and the administration have done a, quote, line-by-line review of the budget, they should have to answer whether they've done this review themselves. Right here next to me on the desk is the President's fiscal year 2012 budget proposal, the document that launches the federal budget cycle and provides the President's views on how Congress should develop budget legislation. It includes volumes on the budget, analytical perspectives, historical tables, and an appendix of detailed budget estimates for each agency. I'd like to ask my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, have you done a line-by-line review of these documents or of Congress's budget? Have you done a line-by-line review of the proposals specifically regarding agencies under this committee's jurisdiction? I'm not asking these questions to suggest that oversight of the budget, particularly the agencies we oversee, is inappropriate. No one can dispute that Congress has a legitimate oversight role with respect to the administration's budgeting process and decisions. Reining in the deficit obviously should be a priority at both ends of Pennsylvania. And I also agree with the chairman that OMB should have sent a witness, and the minority told the administration as much. But the issue is not whether the President or even members of Congress have done a line-by-line review of the budget. Rather, Congress should be taking a close look at substantive questions relating to the budget. We should be asking, are we making appropriate expenditures to promote job creation, biomedical research, and ensure important public health and safety protections for the American public? We should be asking whether we should be cutting the budget for unnecessary wars or duplicative programs. We should be working to ensure that programs that serve the nation's neediest do not receive disproportionate cuts, while subsidies to multi-billion dollar industries remain intact. I hope that today's hearing will provide a constructive examination of the budget process under President Obama. To that end, let's review some basic facts. When President Obama took office, he inherited a deficit over $1 trillion created in large part by two massive tax cuts, a new Medicare prescription drug program not paid for, and wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, none of which was paid for on budget by the Bush administration. The Obama administration proposed a budget that would have cut this deficit in half by 2013. In his first two budgets, President Obama identified 120 terminations, reductions, and savings totaling $20 billion in each year. His 2012 budget proposal proposed 211 terminations, reductions, and savings amounting to an estimated $33 billion in savings for 2012. These budgets were marked by a new level of transparency as well. For example, unlike his predecessor who kept the war funding off the books, President Obama's budget acknowledged the conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan, and that they had an impact on our nation's bottom line. Now, this approach stands in stark contrast to the approach of my friends on the other side of the aisle, who would impose massive cuts on Medicare and Medicaid, balancing the budget on the backs of seniors, the poor, and the middle class, while cutting taxes for millionaires and billionaires. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses about how the budget process has been improved in the Obama administration and could be improved further, particularly with respect to budget issues affecting programs under the committee's jurisdiction. And I hope that today's discussion is fact-based and productive. I yield back.
Thank you, gentlelady. And I recognize the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Barton, for 2 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you know, there's a privacy hearing going on in another subcommittee, so I will have to, after I give them the opening statement, go and attend to that. Mr. Chairman, nearly 3 years ago, then President-elect Obama said, and this is a direct quote, "In these challenging times when we are facing both rising deficits and a sinking economy, budget reform is not an option. It is an imperative. We will go through our federal budget page by page, line by line, eliminating programs we don't need and insisting on those that we do operate in a sensible, cost-effective way," end quote. Well, Mr. Chairman, here we are 3 years and $4 trillion of additional federal debt later, and we still don't have that line-by-line examination. However, House and Senate Democrats, along with the President and his agency administrators, appear to have rejected every effort to truly reform the budget, and as far as I can tell, are spending much more time increasing the financial and regulatory burden on the taxpayers of our nation. Today, I hope that we can begin to uncover what, if anything, the President has done to truly reform our budget and get the nation's fiscal house in order. I want to echo your disappointment, Chairman Stearns, that the Office of Management and Budget could not supply a witness for today's hearing. Perhaps they're too busy meeting with large political donors like those who encouraged the investment in the Solyndra loan guarantee to come before the Congress and tell the American people exactly where their tax dollars are going. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
The gentlelady from Tennessee, Ms. Blackburn, is recognized for 2 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I also am going to be back and forth with the privacy hearing, but I'm like a lot of our colleagues who had great hope when President Obama stated that he would go through the budget line by line to eliminate wasteful and duplicative government programs. I was further encouraged when he stated in Executive Order 13571 that, and I'm quoting, "Government managers must learn from what is working in the private sector and apply these best practices to deliver services better, faster, and at a lower cost," end quote. Unfortunately, while this administration routinely repeats this line, they simultaneously force job creators, innovators, and American taxpayers, hardworking American taxpayers, to the very end of the line, only to pave the way for the golden era of government regulation. Furthermore, I have cause for concern with the President's initiative since the man who oversaw it was Jeffrey Zients, and we heard from him last week on the $500 million Solyndra loan. While Mr. Zients may not be present, it's my hope that we can assist him this morning in carrying out his stated goal on a June 13, 2011 conference call when he said, and I'm quoting, to crack down on waste, step up oversight, and hold bad actors accountable, end quote. I yield back.
Gentlelady yields back, and I recognize the gentleman. Gentleman from Nebraska, yeah. Mr. Terry is recognized.
Appreciate that. I think all of us are united in our effort to reduce the size of government, to eliminate overlapping agency responsibilities, therefore wasteful spending, abusive spending, and simply just making sure that taxpayers have confidence that their money is being used wisely and efficiently, which they do not have that confidence today. So this effort could go a long ways in providing people confidence. I'm disappointed that OMB does not have a representative here to show where we could work together, but also, as the gentlelady from Colorado mentioned, if they are proud of their efforts, then I want to hear what successes they've had, and we could help them perhaps achieve them. There may be obstacles to implementing them within the executive branch that controls the agencies, and my fear is that that's why they aren't here, is because they would probably have to embarrass the executive branch for failing to follow through on the recommendations of those respective agencies. With that, I'll yield back.
Gentleman yields back. The gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Griffith, has 35 seconds, if he'd like.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would just say that I would like to see a line-by-line of the executive branch done by the executive branch, but I also agree that it wouldn't hurt for the congressional offices to take a look line by line on their budgets as well. I think our country needs us working together to find every penny that we can find that would help with our national debt and deficit situation. And I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. And with that, I recognize distinguished ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Waxman, for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not sure what this hearing is all about. If it's about whether the Obama administration has scrutinized the federal budget to eliminate wasteful spending, this is an important hearing, and I support it. But if this hearing is a gotcha hearing to examine whether the administration has actually done a line-by-line review of the federal budget, I reject its premise. There's no question that the Obama administration has carefully examined the federal budget to eliminate wasteful spending. The budget process each year involves close review by each agency of its spending needs. Through its terminations, reductions, and savings review, the Obama administration has recommended cuts in hundreds of programs totaling over $60 billion. But if the question is whether there has been a literal line-by-line review of the federal budget, which Republican members say the President promised, I'm afraid my colleagues have misunderstood a figure of speech. The phrase reading line by line in American English is commonly understood to mean performing a careful review. Likewise, meeting you halfway in negotiations, which seems to be a forgotten act in this Congress, does not mean you literally have to move your chairs closer together. And bridging our differences, another devalued skill, does not involve major construction projects. And I know we're going to get down to brass tacks because our first witness is Mr. Brass, but getting down to brass tacks doesn't mean what some people might have thought it meant when the furniture industry developed the term brass tacks. It means getting down to the facts and reality. Well, these are all figures of speech, and I hope we have not arrived at the absolute bottom of political discourse in which the oversight subcommittee is checking to see if the President's figures of speech are literally true. Unfortunately, I think that the most important question we need to ask is why our budget system has become so dysfunctional. And the answer, I believe, will be found here in Congress, not in the White House. Let's take a brief look at how Republicans have handled the budget in this Congress. First, there was the promise from the Speaker at the beginning of his term, there are not going to be any more omnibus appropriations bills. He told the American Enterprise Institute that he would do away with comprehensive bills. At another point, he said that the House would do all separate appropriations bills and that the 2,000-page bills are not in anyone's interest. Yet today, we're operating on the heels of a four-day continuing resolution, which will be followed by a six-week continuing resolution, which will be followed by an omnibus appropriation, if we're lucky. Then there was the budget ceiling standoff. Every Republican and Democratic economic and financial observer said that this ceiling had to be lifted to preserve the American credit rating and not to rattle the markets. Instead, the Republicans held the ceiling hostage until default was imminent, using it for negotiation leverage and headline value. And now there's a super committee for members who say they want a line-by-line review of the budget and for a party that claims it doesn't want omnibus bills because they're too big to review. It seems pretty strange that the super committee is the method that has been adopted. This process sweeps past all authorizing committees' consideration and all amendments and input from members of Congress. If it is successful, the super committee will create a giant omnibus bill, bigger than any before, and give us perhaps 3 weeks to read it, but not to change it, not even to offer changes to it. If it fails, it will produce an across-the-board cut in programs that could be accomplished by a pocket calculator, but will reflect no public policy, no economic realities, and no sense of justice and fairness. Well, I hope the super committee process achieves positive results, but if we're really serious about ensuring sound fiscal policy for our nation, Congress needs to take a long, hard look in the mirror. I believe that examining ways to meet halfway and bridge differences would take us a lot further than examining whether the President did a line-by-line budget review. And I remember a conversation I had with my son when he was quite little, and we had to explain to him that stopping on a dime did not mean we literally stopped for a dime. There are figures of speech and expressions, and I'm pleased now that the Oversight Committee has become the arbiter of whether people are actually stopping on a dime, getting down to brass tacks, literally reading a budget line by line. This is a wonderful exercise. I only wish the cameras were here so that the American people could see what Congress has come to. And I think my time has now expired, so I will yield back.
Thanks, gentlemen. I hope the gentleman will stay for the questions that I'll have. I'm going to actually show the video clip of the President mentioning.
Nothing could make me more excited, Mr. Chairman.
So if I
can do that, I'll certainly try to get back.
Yeah, line by line.
Otherwise, I'm going to read the testimony line by line very carefully.
Okay. Well, you wouldn't want to miss the President mentioning line by line, and you'll clearly understand his intent with this video clip. I ask unanimous consent again from the gentlelady that the majority supplemental memo and attached letter from OMB be introduced into the record. Without objection, the documents will be entered into the record. And with that, Mr. Brass, you are aware that the committee is holding an investigative hearing, and when doing so, has had the practice of taking testimony under oath. Do you have any objection to taking testimony under oath? The chair then advises you that under the rules of the House and the rules of the committee, you are entitled to be advised by counsel. Do you desire to be advised by counsel during your testimony today?
No, Mr. Chairman.
In that case, if please rise and raise your right hand, I will swear you in. Do you swear the testimony that you're about to give is the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you, Mr. Brass. Mr. Brass, you are now under oath and subject to the penalty set forth in Title 18, Section 1001 of the United States Code. You may now give your five-minute opening statement. Please proceed.
Thank you. Chairman Stearns, Ranking Member DeGette, members of the subcommittee, Thank you for the invitation to testify today. The subcommittee requested that CRS discuss the Obama administration's line-by-line budget review and what it appears to entail. The subcommittee also requests to be closely related to the annual development of the president's budget proposals. The line-by-line review may be another name for the Obama administration's perspective on how it formulates the president's budget. The first mention of this topic appeared during the 2008 presidential campaign and subsequent transition. The incoming administration characterized the effort as an exhaustive line-by-line review of the budget, in which the administration would focus not only on identifying cuts, but also more generally on how to allocate funds. In February 2009, OMB released an initial budget overview for the upcoming fiscal year, saying it had begun a line-by-line review and would release related proposals for that and subsequent fiscal years. In May 2009, the administration issued a document that included selected proposals for, quote, terminations, reductions, and savings, unquote. The Obama administration's issuance of a volume like this among a president's budget proposals was not new. Presidents dating back to President Ronald Reagan, if not before, have occasionally produced similar documents. The Obama administration characterized the document as the first report from the line-by-line effort. On the same day, OMB released a more comprehensive budget appendix with account-by-account budget proposals. Agencies also submitted to Congress their much more detailed budget justifications. In subsequent years, the Obama administration released similar sets of documents. In these documents, representations that an administration makes about the performance of a program may provide information that not all observers would necessarily perceive to be complete or fair. Past experience suggests that a president may, in some cases, make representations about performance from the perspective of one definition of success while omitting any mention of other perspectives. Consequently, Congress may consider whether the definition of success that is being used reflects underlying authorizing statutes or congressional intent. Congress has indicated in statute that when agencies set goals and arguably thereby define success, the agencies are first required to consult with Congress and stakeholders. Statutes like this may provide Congress with an opportunity to influence how agencies and OMB present information to Congress. The subcommittee also requested that CRS identify some policy options that Congress might consider to accomplish the following outcomes. These include bringing additional transparency to presidential budget proposals, including the outcomes of such proposals after Congress considers them. Options to bring enhanced credibility to representations that an administration may make regarding an agency's or program's performance, and options to bring more effective engagement between Congress and agencies on topics like these. The CRS written statement mentions a few options, and CRS takes no position on whether changes from the status quo are advisable. However, some potential advantages and disadvantages might be explored if options were of further interest. In the meantime, I would be happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Mr. Brass, thank you. I'd like to lead off with my questions, but before I do, I would like to play the following video clip, if I could.
I want to go line by line through every item in the federal budget and eliminate programs that don't work and make sure that those that do work better and cheaper. I will ask my new team to think anew and act anew to meet our new challenge. We are going to go through our federal budget, as I promised during the campaign, page by page, line by line, eliminating those programs we don't need and insisting that those that we do need operate in a sensible, cost-effective way. That's why I've charged the Office of Management and Budget, led by Peter Orszag and Rob Neighbors, who are standing behind me today, with going through the budget, program by program, item by item, line by line, looking for areas where we can save taxpayer dollars.
Well, I think it's clear from that video, contrary to what Mr. Waxman indicated, the president indicated he's going page by page, line by line, item by item, program by program. So it's unfortunate Mr. Waxman is not here that to show that he meant, the president, that is, meant literally to go that way.
Well, the chairman yelled. You know the president didn't go through the budget line by line?
Well, it appears that Mr. Waxman was trying to indicate the president did not have to go line by line.
Well, do we know if he did or didn't?
Well, you should ask Mr. Waxman.
Why?
Well, Mr. Waxman's making the charge. Mr. Brass, let me ask you the question, just to put it on the record. Did the president issue an executive order after he took office directing the executive branch to undertake a line-by-line analysis of the federal budget?
No, Mr. Chairman.
He did not?
He did not issue an executive order. That's correct.
Did OMB issue a specific directive to this effect?
That is unknown, not in public form. There may be internal guidance that may have gone out to agencies or OMB examiners, but from what is publicly available, I've seen no such document.
So I think the basic fact is the president, we saw from the video, has talked about line by line, item by item, program by program, page by page, yet you're telling us this morning the president did not issue an executive order to the office to undertake a line by line analysis, so that's a little disconcerting. Other than the video clips that you saw moments ago, is there anything that you have come across in your research and analysis that defines or better explains what a line-by-line review of the budget entails?
I have only seen general representations of what is involved in a line-by-line review. When I initially saw it, I wasn't sure what it meant to review something line-by-line in budget jargon.
Mm-hmm.
Can have several meanings. My interpretation generally from the statements that have come out were that the president was signaling internally in the government and externally that he wanted to bring focus and scrutiny to all government programs.
Well, let me just back up a bit. How does that characterization compare with how the Obama administration has conducted its line-by-line analysis? I mean, how does it compare in real life?
That's a good question, and unfortunately, I was not at OMB at the time to be able to observe that, because in some ways the formulation of the president's budget occurs within a black box where it's not subject to public view, and so it's hard to say exactly what occurs.
Well, let's go back to other administrations. How would you compare how prior administration conducted an annual budget analysis? Can you give briefly what your observations have been?
Well, in the past, what is known is that the president's budget is formulated through a rather elaborate process of agency submitting requests to OMB, OMB passing back initial determinations back.
Did prior administrations use a line-by-line analysis, in your opinion?
Not in those words, no.
Not in those words. In your review of the Obama administration's line-by-line review, did you find any example of decision-making taking place that was based on evidence-based analyses?
I saw references to evidence-based analyses and citations to program evaluations and that sort of thing. And so there have been some instances, yes, where the administration has said proposals were based on evidence.
Did they result in actual cuts being made, in your opinion?
I have not examined empirically, item by item, whether they were ultimately adopted.
Forget the word empirically. Have there any cuts made that you can see?
I have not examined that. So what I have focused, that gets at the transparency issue to some extent.
So you're saying if they were, you can't tell them, and if they're not, you still can't tell them?
I should preface that by saying I could tell if I spent a lot of time looking at it, but it's difficult to find time to go through a document.
Do you think
that
the average person could, if they took the time, could find the cuts?
I don't know if I'm the average person or not, but I could not easily find whether cuts were made.
Is it possible there were no cuts?
I doubt that, but...
That's a possibility. Let me ask you this. Are there different ways to conduct an exhaustive line-by-line review beyond what occurs in the annual budget process, and what are they?
Certainly. You can have special processes that go on parallel to the budget process. In past administrations, you had what was called, for example, under the Jimmy Carter administration, zero-based budgeting, which was an effort to assume that nothing would continue, where agencies would have to justify everything in their budget all over again. So, yeah, many, many techniques and approaches are possible.
I thank the gentleman and recognize the ranking member, Ms. DeGette.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Well, let me just say at the outset what I said in my opening statement. I join you in wishing that we had someone from OMB here, because, Mr. Brass, you work for the Congressional Research Service, which is an arm of Congress, correct?
That's correct.
You don't work for the executive branch, correct?
That's correct.
Now, I'm going to assume you have not talked to the president about whether he, in fact, went through the budget line by line as that extremely cute video showed, correct?
That's correct.
And you haven't talked to anybody over at OMB to see if they went through it line by line over at OMB, have you?
Not in a way that I could attribute, no.
Okay. And have you talked to the people over at OMB about whether they did a thorough analysis and investigation of the budget to see where cuts and adjustments could be made?
Informally.
And what were you told by OMB?
Well, full disclosure, I used to work at OMB before I came to CRS. And
okay.
So
but when did you leave OMB?
In 2003.
Okay. So you haven't been at OMB for like 7+ years.
That's correct.
Right? And you left when a different administration was there too, right?
That's correct.
So to ask the question again, did you talk to your former colleagues at OMB about whether they did a thorough investigation and analysis of this budget?
Informally, yes.
And what did they say?
They said that they went through the president's budget formulation process, which is rather elaborate and extensive.
Okay. Now, in response to one of the chairman's questions, you said that your view of line-by-line analysis means a focus and a scrutiny given to all government programs, right? I wrote that down when you said that.
That is one possible, yes, interpretation.
Okay. And do you have any sense whether the administration gave a focus and scrutiny to all government programs when they proposed their budget to Congress?
That's, I don't think it's possible for CRS to authoritatively say
you,
whether
you
or not.
You don't know.
That's correct.
Right. Now, as I mentioned in my opening statement, the administration sends a budget to Congress, but Congress plays a role in developing the federal budget as well. Isn't that correct?
That's correct.
And in fact, the Constitution places the primary responsibility for the federal budget at Congress's feet, not the president, right?
That is correct.
So, I mean, the president could send us a budget, we could throw it in the trash, which we often do, and make our own budget, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, Congress is expected to pass a budget resolution and 12 separate appropriations bills for fiscal year 2012, is it not?
Yes, ma'am.
And so I was a little confused when the chairman was asking you, were cuts made in the president's budget? Because, in fact, the only body that can actually make cuts is Congress when it passes those 12 appropriation bills, right?
Cuts are made from, figuratively, from previous spending amounts.
Right.
Or cuts
so,
are made from
so
the proposal.
there's a spending amount from last year, and then Congress passes an appropriations bill which either increases the appropriation or cuts the appropriation, right?
Congress and the president jointly.
Right. The president can't unilaterally make cuts. He can propose cuts. Right?
That's correct.
The only way you actually make cuts is if Congress passes legislation, which the president then signs, correct?
That's correct.
Now, do you know whether the president has proposed cuts to any programs in his budget to Congress?
Yes, he has.
Yes, he has. And do you know offhand how many cuts those are?
I have not racked up the figures. No.
Okay. Now, so just to summarize, you don't know whether the president or anyone over at OMB or in his administration actually went through the budget line by line. Is that right?
That is correct. I do not personally know that.
Okay. And you do know, well, you know from talking to your buddies over at OMB that there was some rigorous analysis done of the budget over at the White House, correct?
That is how examiners at OMB would characterize that, yes.
Okay. And you know that the administration gave us a proposed budget which did include proposals for cuts to some programs, correct?
That's correct.
Now, have you yourself read the president's proposed budget line by line?
No, ma'am.
No. Do you know anybody who has?
I do not.
Okay. Because generally, like when you used to work at OMB and now you work at CRS, people mean an overall review when they say line. It's a figure of speech, generally speaking, right?
That's one interpretation of the use of the term here.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think the gentlelady, I think your questioning point out the reason why we need OMB here.
Totally.
And secondly, we got documents from OMB Friday night, and it turns out all those documents are already in the public record. So in addition to not being here, they sort of foolishly and subversively submitted documents that were already in the public record. So I think it's a double sort of slightly affront that they're not here. And it's unfortunate when your questions are asked.
Mr. Chairman, did you ask OMB for those records?
We sure did.
So if they didn't give you the records, you'd be mad at them. So now you're mad at them because they did give
you. No, they gave us records that were already in public record. It's like getting a book that you already have in your library.
Are there records that you asked for that
yes.
they didn't give you? Work on that.
Okay, let's work on that. With that, I recognize Mr. Murphy, gentleman from Pennsylvania. Not here. Mr. Griffith's recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You say the president has proposed some cuts to the budget, but overall the budget's going up, so they've had more increases in their proposals than they had decreases. Is that not correct?
I don't know. I don't cover the budgetary aggregates at CRS. But I'd be happy to get folks in touch with you or your office on that question.
Okay.
I do more kind of budget process, program evaluation, the role of agencies and OMB and the president in the budget process, focusing less on what empirically occurs year to year.
You would agree that in the clips that we saw, the president made it clear that he was going to do a careful analysis of what was going on in the budget. In your area is the budget process. Have you seen any signs that the president has made any recommendations to Congress in ways that we could make the budget process more transparent for the American public?
Yes, they have put out this TRS volume, this termination reductions and savings volume. It's not required by law. The George W. Bush administration also did that to highlight budget cut proposals. And so there are some examples like that where some transparency is occurring beyond what is required by law.
All right. But the same thing was done by the Bush administration, so there's not been any new innovation by the Obama administration. Would that be correct to say?
Not necessarily in that respect, with the caveat that it's difficult to know what's going on in the background. Yes.
All right. That's why we like transparency, because it's difficult to know what's going on in the background. Isn't that correct?
Many people like transparency for that reason. Yes, sir.
All right. And as a part of that in the budget process, has the White House made any recommendations that you're aware of to Congress that would make the process smoother, easier, et cetera, such as maybe moving to a biennial budget?
That is another area I don't cover closely at CRS. I'm sorry. There is a chapter usually in the budget appendix. Excuse me, not the appendix, but the analytical perspectives volume of the president's budget that focuses on the congressional budget process. But there have been some allusions to, for example, enhanced rescission authority, that kind of thing. That's not a subject that I follow closely.
Okay. So you don't have a recommendation you don't know of any recommendations from the White House or the administrative branch of government that might make the process in the budget a little smoother?
Not right offhand. I could get back to you on that, though.
Yeah, if you could get back to me on that. Do you think that a biennial budget would be a smoother process and smooth out some of the bumps in the road that we've experienced in this, my first term?
That is a question that comes up frequently. A biennial budget would allow Congress to look at 2 years of expenditures at a time, and advocates have focused on using that second year for additional oversight. And another argument that they use to plug that proposal is that it would allow Congress to focus more in-depth time during that consideration. That said, there might be some disadvantages too. The budget process, in a way, is an annual way of holding agencies accountable, and if they're only held accountable every 2 years with a budgetary hammer, it might weaken congressional controls.
You haven't seen any indications that the White House has been working on ways to smooth out the process or make recommendations that might smooth out the process for the various administrations that the White House is, administrative agencies that the White House is responsible for overseeing and making sure that they work smoothly. You haven't seen anything like that.
Unfortunately, again, when it comes to proposals like that, many of them relate to the congressional budget process. I focus more on what's going on within the executive branch. Within the executive branch, I've not seen big initiatives to open the lid, for example, on formulation of the president's budget.
So that is not something, so we're not sure whether they've done line by line, whether figurative or otherwise, and we've not seen anything where, you've not seen anything where it looks like they're opening the lid to look at making the process smoother, whether it be the biennial budget or any other proposal, that they're just not looking in that direction. Would that be a fair characterization of what you just said?
I'll have to get back to you on that, Mr. Griffith. I'll need to...
But it's fairly reasonable, based on what you just said, that you have not seen anything along those lines. Is that correct?
I would characterize it just that it's been a busy couple of years and I've been focused on other topics, and so things aren't coming readily to mind. That doesn't mean they're not out there, though.
Okay. Certainly nothing front burner. Might be some back burner stuff. Is that what you're saying? And I yield back my time, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back his time. We recognize the gentlelady from the Virgin Islands, Dr. Christensen, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have to say that as I read the memo and some of the testimony, this seems like a hearing looking for a reason to exist. And I have to agree also with Chairman Waxman, Ranking Member Waxman, that seasoned members who admittedly rarely read budget bills can't be taking that line-by-line statement literally. I might agree to looking at developing clearer guidelines, goals, and principles, but I think we have to recognize that we're not the executive branch and be careful not to usurp their authority and to use the authority that we do have to address some of these issues. Let me preface my questions by saying some of my Republican colleagues on the subcommittee appear to be calling into question whether the Obama administration has done a thoughtful review of budget issues. In their September 15, 2011 letters to OMB and other agencies, Chairman Stearns and Chairman Upton cited a statement by the White House press secretary that the president had not gone line by line through omnibus spending legislation as a concession that raises questions about fiscal discipline in the administration. In order to best understand the attention the administration has paid to budget issues, I think it would be helpful to walk through the process involved in preparing the president's budget. So, Mr. Brass, it is my understanding that government agencies, one of my favorites, say the National Institutes of Health, begin the development of their budgets far before the beginning of the fiscal year. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And I also understand that agencies like NIH prepare a first draft and then submit them for review to the department of which they are part, in this case, HHS. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And do all agency proposals make it through the departmental review, to the best of your knowledge?
No, they do not.
Okay. And then departments prepare their budgets for review by the Office of Management and Budget. Is that part of the process?
That is correct.
Do all departmental proposals make it through the OMB process?
They do not.
In fact, OMB tells departments what proposals it will support and which ones it will discard in a document that's usually known as the OMB passbook. Is that correct?
Passback, correct.
Passback. As a matter of fact, I remember going to the White House and when we were doing the health care reform bill, and we had several issues that we wanted the president to consider. This is an aside. And the president actually said to me, I'm not going to support anything that doesn't work. So I've seen some of this process in action. But let me go on with my questions. I also understand that cabinet members get one last chance to propose an item for the budget in a process that is an appeal to the president and the OMB director in a process that's called appeals. Is that a part of the process as well?
Yes, it is.
So do all cabinet members' appeals get granted?
No, they do not.
Okay. Is this the procedure, meaning the agency proposes to the department proposes to OMB, the OMB passes back a decision, the secretary appeals to the president, and final decisions are made. Is this procedure used by both Democratic, and has it been used by both Democratic and Republican administrations?
Yes, it is. It's a longstanding practice.
To the best of your knowledge, when this procedure is being followed, does anyone review the entire federal budget line by line?
Again, that's a figure of speech that's subject to interpretation, but if it's meant actually reading every line and not figurative, no, I do not know of anyone who reads the entirety of it.
Well, in your opinion, does not reading it line by line and going through it line by line, but really doing a careful review, doesn't that kind of equate to each other?
So in colloquial speech, to do a line-by-line examination of something frequently means a careful, exhaustive, scrutinizing review of a document. So, yes.
And yet both Republican and Democratic administrations do produce budget proposals despite going through that process and not having done a line-by-line. But we end up with a budget regardless of what administration is in office.
Presumably, yes, just, again, not having observed it personally, but, yes, reports are.
So, well, I just want to thank you for your responses. As we evaluate whether there are ways to improve the budget process, it's helpful to understand the existing process, which is lengthy and involves detailed analysis from experts at agencies across the administration. I'd also just like to say that I think that an honest and objective look at what President Obama and his team have done in his tenure would clearly show that the President has done much to eliminate duplication, waste, fraud, and abuse, and cut spending. And as a matter of fact, in going along with what the Tea Party Republicans have called for in cuts while we're still in a deep depression, I think the President has gone too far. And I yield back the balance of my time, Mr. Chair.
Gentleman from Nebraska, recognized for 5 minutes.
Well, I appreciate what my tax and spend liberal, uber liberal Democrat friends state in their statements here. Let me just go through, try and get this clear in my mind. We can play that game too, Donna. Now, Mr. Brass. Pardon me?
They've hurt middle class and poor Americans, and they've gone too far. That's my
point. By trying to restrain spending. Let's look at that. Who decides the head of agencies,
Who appoints them?
Yeah. Well, who makes the determination of who will be the secretary or director of an agency?
It's joint between the president making an appointment and the Senate
confirming
them.
And the management, day-to-day management, is the executive branch, right?
That's correct.
And they answer to the president, correct?
That's correct.
And I think the gentlelady from the Virgin Islands made the good point that the processes in budgeting is that the respective agencies, since they answer to the executive branch, start their budgeting process really right now and then submit those to OMB, which is an executive office branch, right? Or an executive office agency.
It's an executive branch entity, yes. And the process starts in the spring and summer preceding February submission of the president's budget.
They don't submit those to Congress. They submit those to the president.
In general, yes. There are agencies where Congress has seen fit to carve them out from the law requiring that a budget be submitted to OMB first. Some
That's
agencies
the exception.
Are authorized to submit directly to Congress.
Right. And those are the exceptions. But generally, all the agencies submit their proposed budgets to OMB. The president and OMB make reviews of those budgets before they put them in the president's budget, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And then when the president decides whether there should be, whether they have found duplicative agencies or sub-agencies, does the president have to come to Congress to eliminate a sub-agency?
If the sub-agency is established by law, yes. If a sub-agency is created through administrative action, the appropriations committees may get involved, where in report language they require some communication to occur.
Are you aware of any instance where the executive branch has eliminated a duplicative sub-agency? We know that no agency has been eliminated, so it has to be the sub-agencies within an agency. So are you aware of whether by executive order or by request for legislation and one has been eliminated?
I have not studied that question in detail, so I'd have
to. Who would we ask?
At CRS?
Just generally, can CRS answer that question for us if we request it?
Sure, of course.
Or would we have to have OMB here?
You could, to get a complete answer, you might ask both. CRS oftentimes is constrained to readily publicly available resources, something like that. Also, you might ask GAO for a more in-depth examination.
All right. Then if we want to know what recommendations OMB has made after their review of the budgets, we'd have to ask them.
Well, their recommendations, you could ask them, but their recommendations are, generally speaking, in publicly right. available documents. The challenge oftentimes is going through them in detail and discerning what is a budget cut to a program where the program still exists or an agency still or an entity still exists versus what is a zeroing out
now,
of an entity.
I appreciate that. Then, in that regard, to exercising our constitutional rights, we do have a budget. The Republican House did pass a budget, so the issue isn't whether we're exercising our discretion or constitutional, it's whether they agree with our cuts or changes. Are you aware whether the Senate has passed a budget?
A budget resolution?
Budget resolution.
I believe they have not.
I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. The gentleman from California, Mr. Bilbrin, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Yeah, let me say, first of all, Mr. Chairman, I commend you at having this hearing. In fact, I probably, if I was going to be a complaint, we should have had it before. Any member that thinks that this is a meeting, a hearing without a problem, needs to take a look at 43%. Deficit running up. We're 43% underwater. There's not a city, a county, or a state in this country that would think that 43% underwater is viable. Mr. Brassi, you know any? Can we name off just what's a city? Maybe Philadelphia. What? Can we find somebody that's 43% annually underwater?
I don't cover that area. I'm sure it's...
Okay,
sure
let me assure you, in California, which has one of the worst economic downturns in the entire country, I mean, we have unemployment over 12%. We don't have that. And so, you know, I just think that we got to recognize there is a reason to have this hearing. It should have been held before. And I don't think that it's just a problem that we can point to the White House. Even though the leader of the Senate happens to be a family friend in the Bilbrays, to take a look at the fact that it appears the Senate has not done their due diligence to the budget for basically have delayed it almost three times longer than what they're supposed to be doing, I think there's a lot of concern we should have with everybody in this process. I've got to just say personally, Mr. Chairman, it kind of reminds me of when Proposition 13 passed in 1978. I was a young 27-year-old mayor, and we had to make 40% cuts to be able, because that's what we lost in revenue in 1978. And so if I sound like it's deja vu all over again, there's a reason to it. Sadly, I got to tell you that we ended up having to disband our police department because of the fiscal issues. But Now you ought to try to make the fund cuts like that, and then hope to ever get the endorsement of the police department again. Zero-based budgeting seems like a no-brainer when you're sitting at the 43. When we were challenged with this, and I'm saying across the state of California, everybody went to zero-based. Every item had to be justified. What would be the justification for not doing zero-based?
Zero-based budgeting can be implemented in different ways, and in fact, people may interpret it differently. I can reflect back on the experience in the Jimmy Carter administration where GAO did a study 2 years after it was implemented that found that it was quite burdensome to go through. The notion of zero base, that is not just doing incremental budgeting, but actually looking at everything, many budget analysts would agree is a correct thing to do. But some of the art and science of budgeting is how to do things like that. So one of the troubles there is just identifying what is meant by zero-based budgeting.
Okay, let's go with the biannual budget system. Some members may forget, but under a Democratic Congress, Democratic White House, we passed bipartisan support for a biannual budget for the veterans. Have we run into any major problems with the Veterans Department being on a biannual budget?
I don't know. I don't follow that area closely.
Okay, Mr. Brass, let me just tell you, one advantage was when we get through these crises, the veterans were addressed during the CR because we were on that, and I challenged both sides that we found bipartisan support for a biannual budget for the veterans. Maybe we ought to be considering maybe this is one place that Republicans and Democrats can cooperate and start expanding this this effort. I've heard of lockbox. Blackbox is sort of an interesting new term as somebody who's been around the block a couple times. And I'm just wondering about this concept of budgeting and not really allowing anybody to know what's going in on that. And I'm wondering, how far does this go? The executive branch will keep it in the dark all the time, ever, and only until they release their budget. No one has the right to be able to know what's being said or what's being proposed.
People have argued that they have the right. Committees with subpoena power can certainly go after certain information that is considered pre-decisional in the executive branch. But this goes back to 1921 with a law called the Budget and Accounting Act, where Congress told agency personnel, do not submit budgets directly to Congress. You have to go through the filter of the institutional presidency before that is submitted. And so presidents have used that law to shield some of what goes on inside the executive branch. That said, Congress has occasionally, for specific agencies, removed that lid to.
Well, I think that as much as possible with him. Mr. Chairman, I appreciate it. I just want to point out one thing. A lot of people talk about budget cuts and hitting the poor and the needy, but let me remind you, when the economy goes south, when the system crashes, it's not the rich and the powerful that get hurt. When there's an irresponsible budget handling, it's the poor and the needy always ends up being hit. It's not the rich guys along the line. And if anybody believes that the president's been responsible on every expenditure in the budget and agrees with this, I've looked at everything. Maybe they ought to look at so-called green fuel technology subsidies or certain money that's gone into certain renewable strategies that no science in the world would support, but the administration has, and I yield back.
Thanks, gentlemen. And the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Brass, an underlying concern of my Republican colleagues at today's hearings appears to be the President of the United States did not conduct a line-by-line review of the budget proposal he submitted to Congress. For example, in requesting information from the agencies on line-by-line budget review, the letters from the subcommittee and the full committee chairs underscore that President's secretary conceded that the President did not conduct a line-by-line review of the omnibus spending bill in 2009. Let me start with a few questions, just simple yes and no. Mr. Brass, with your information, can you tell us for certain whether the President read every word of the 2012 budget proposal?
I cannot.
Okay. Ms. Brass, have you ever read the entire budget submission by the President? Do you have any sense of how long that would take?
I have not. It would take a long time.
Okay. And would you expect the President to read every word of his budget proposal?
I would be surprised if the President were able to do that.
Now, there's no question there are differences between the Obama administration and my colleagues across the aisle regarding priorities of federal spending. I'm concerned, however, that the series of hearings our subcommittee is launching today is serving more as a forum for airing grievances about the Obama administration's policy priorities rather than a meaningful attempt to improve the budget review process. And I think all of us want to improve the process. Mr. Brass, do you believe that a line-by-line reading of the federal budget is likely to lead to dramatic changes to federal programs like turning Medicare into a voucher program? Are those sorts of discussions more likely to be made in the context of high-level policy decisions?
I would say that that hinges on how one defines a line-by-line review. If line-by-line review is interpreted as an exhaustive examination of the budget and fiscal policy more generally, then major policy changes could be proposed coming out of that.
Okay. But it's still a line-by-line, those is only the basic part you have to do. You have to understand the budget before you then come back and say, okay, these are some of the policy decisions we may need. And those policy differences would be obviously party differences, regional differences, and lots of different differences that could get there. Mr. Brass, I think it's appropriate for Congress to examine whether the cuts and priorities reflected in the President's budget or proposal are fair and wise. I'm not convinced, however, that reiterating demands for the President to conduct a line-by-line budget review is the most productive means on carrying out this goal. Maybe in Congress we ought to require line-by-line review of the budget from our side, from one of the branches of government. And I'll close by, Mr. Chairman, I had a served in the legislature a number of years, and I had a state House member who had served many, many years before me. And he said when he was first elected, his first term, he read every bill that was introduced into the state legislature. His second term, he realized that was impossible because he was reading bills that would never see the light of day. He tried to read all the ones in his committee. And by the time his third term came around, he tried to read the ones he's introduced. So, sometimes reading it, it's more the comprehension than it is just reading a line. It's actually comprehending what it is. And I appreciate the time, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, gentlemen. And since you have a minute and 40 seconds left, I might have a colloquy with you.
Oh, I'd love to.
You weren't here when we showed the video of the President in which he said he was going to go not only line by line, he said he was going to go page by page, item by item, program by program. Then we thought, well, let's go back and see what the OMB director, Jack Lew, said in his testimony before the House Budget Committee on February 15, 2011. This is an exact quote from him. Each year since entering office, President Obama has asked his administration to go line by line through the budget to identify programs that are outdated, ineffective, and duplicative. So I just submit to the gentleman, this doesn't sound like he thinks it was just a figure of speech, and I think in all deference to you and your side, you're trying to interpret this that the President didn't mean to go line by line, but it appears from what he said and from what his OMB director said that he actually wanted to go, and that was his intent, at least to say.
If I could reclaim my time,
sure.
Since you're the chair and you can have all the time
you want.
And I agree, but the President has an Office of Management and Budget who has staff that can do that. And I would
hope
that they would have staff who could do that and look at it. But I think the big issue is that we need to look at the policy decisions, whether it be the President makes, whether it's this President makes, or previous, or the next President. That's our issue. And instead of focusing on whether the President read every line, and or maybe he had one of those literally dozens, if not hundreds, of people who work for the Office of Management and Budget or in any of the agencies to say, okay, I want you to do this. I think that can happen, but let's talk about the policies and the priorities instead of just, getting into whether somebody read a line or not, because I don't think...
Well, I agree with that program. We should look at the big picture, but I'm just saying that we're trying to be fair to the president. But the other point is we can't find out.
I would be shocked.
And we also can't even find out what in the view of his line by line, item by item, program by program, page by page, we can't find any of these cuts. So we're going to move off Mr. Brass to our second panel and ask them to come forward. Let me, while they're setting up here, panel two is Thomas Schwartz, president. Schatz, president of Citizen Against Government Waste. Mr. Kutson, Patrick Kutson, Grover M. Herman Senior Fellow in Federal Budgetary Affairs, the Heritage Foundation. Veronique Q. D. Ruggi, Senior Research Fellow, the Makeda Center for George Mason University, Tad Haven, a Budget Analyst, Cato Institute, Andrew Moylan, Vice President of Government Affairs, National Taxpayers Union, and Gary Kalman, Director, Federal Legislative Office, USPIRG. So with that, I think we got everybody. Did we introduce everybody? We have a few more. We have Stan Cullender, OCOR, and Scott Lilly, Center for American Progress. We got all of them in? Okay. All right, gentlemen. Looks like we got you all lined up here. All of you are aware that the committee is holding an investigative hearing, and when doing so, has the practice of taking testimony under oath. Do you have any objection to taking testimony under oath? The chair then advises you that under the rules of the House and rules of the committee, you are entitled to be advised by counsel. Do any of you wish to be advised by counsel? In that case, you please rise and raise your right hand. Do you swear that the testimony you're about to give is the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God? No, thank you. You're now under oath and subject to the penalty set forth in Title 18, Section 1001 of the United States Code. You may now each give a opening statement of 5 minutes, and we'll recognize Mr. Schatz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee. I appreciate being here today. My name is Thomas Schatz. I'm president of Citizens Against Government Waste, a nonprofit organization dedicated to eliminating waste, fraud, abuse, and government. We have more than 1 million supporters and members nationwide. On November 25, 2008, President-elect Barack Obama vowed to conduct a page-by-page, line-by-line review of the budget to eliminate unneeded programs and increase the efficiency of the rest of the government. On May 7, 2009, OMB Director Peter Orszag said that there was a significant installment in this effort when they released the fiscal year 2012 Terminations, Reductions, and Savings document, which identified 100 recommendations that would reduce federal spending by $17 billion over 1 year. While the identification of these savings was laudable, it was not unique, as the prior witness has stated. A list of terminations, reductions, and savings has been submitted to Congress each year since 2006. A list of similar proposals entitled Major Policy Initiatives was submitted by President Reagan throughout his 2 terms in office. Now, the line-by-line review of the budget is one of 6 initiatives that President Obama has launched in an effort to streamline the federal government and cut costs. Most recently, on June 13, 2011, he issued an executive order to deliver an efficient, effective, and accountable government. And while the words line-by-line do not appear, he both identified previous proposals and created new initiatives. He talked about prior achievements and good progress, but there was no list of accomplishments, including how much money had been saved by taxpayers or what had been implemented from any prior lists. Now, the subcommittee's request for information on the implementation of the review is therefore appropriate, but the administration should already be answering these questions, and there should be one place in the budget where this information is available. We have found over the years that the most effective method of promoting an initiative to increase efficiency has been to announce a single major idea and provide information about progress and results. President Reagan created the President's Private Sector Survey on Cost Control, better known as the Grace Commission. President Clinton had the National Performance Review, and President George W. Bush initiated the Program Assessment Rating Tool. And to achieve any level of success, such initiatives require a clear methodology, an appropriate time frame, transparent reporting, and concrete steps to ensure that the recommendations are adopted. When the Grace Commission completed its report in January 1984, Commission Chairman J. Peter Grace joined with syndicated columnist Jack Anderson to create CAGW to follow up on the recommendations. President Reagan immediately submitted recommendations of the Grace Commission in his annual budgets as part of the volume called Management of the United States Government. In fiscal year 1986, Appendix B described how the President had accepted 80% of the Grace Commission's unduplicated recommendations and that 326 recommendations would be included in the following year's budget. The management report in 1987 noted the adoption of those 326 recommendations would save $7.4 billion in 1 year and $68.8 billion over 5 years, and that $30.6 billion was included in the budget baseline for the prior fiscal year. Similar reports were included in the fiscal year 1988 management report and 1989 management reports, and that last report showed that $40.5 billion had been included in the 1989 budget baseline. And despite the clarity and efficacy of these management reports, they disappeared after the Reagan administration, and nothing of similar substance and value has taken their place. In March 1993, President Clinton asked Vice President Gore to spearhead the National Performance Review, a six-month project that ended up detailing 1,250 specific actions intended to save $108 billion. Eventually, one quarter of those recommendations requiring legislation were adopted. And in July 2002, the Bush administration launched the Program Assessment Rating Tool. This technique was used in the President's 2004 budget. It was specifically identified. The website expectmore.gov was also created to track the evaluations. In order for taxpayers to determine whether President Obama is achieving success in his line-by-line examination of federal spending or his other initiatives, the results really should be provided clearly and concisely and on a regular basis. And really, new initiatives should not be announced without demonstrating substantial progress in the administration's current efforts to improve efficiency and effectiveness in government. The President, when he was in the Senate, did support and co-sponsor the Federal Accountability and Transparency Act. There is USAspending.gov as a result, and a similar type of transparent reporting would be very helpful to taxpayers to determine whether the Obama administration is making progress on its efforts to eliminate wasteful spending. That concludes my testimony. I ask that my full statement be submitted for the record. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I shall be accepted. Mr. Davin.
Members of the committee, thank you for inviting me to testify. After the November 2008 election, President-elect Obama pledged his Office of Management and Budget. We'll go through a budget, federal budget, page by page, line by line, eliminating those programs we don't need. When the President released his first budget proposal in May of 2009, it included a separate volume, Terminations, Reductions, and Savings, which identified $17 billion in savings for fiscal 2010. To put that figure in perspective, the President proposed to spend $3.6 trillion that year, which means that he proposed savings equal to 0.47% of what he planned to spend. Assuming that OMB did conduct a line-by-line review of the federal budget, the President's proposal implied that he believed that 99.53% of the federal government was definitely needed at a time when we're running deficits in excess of $1 trillion. Did OMB really conduct a thorough line-by-line search of the federal budget for savings? The list of savings created an aura of thoroughness because it targeted some obscure programs. For example, the proposed savings included terminating tiny programs like the Christopher Columbus Fellowship Foundation, $1 million saved, the Javits Gifted and Talented Education Program, $7 million saved, and all the administration identified and provided a detailed explanation for 121 targets for savings. The fact that the administration proposed to cut what amounts to needles in the budgetary haystack suggests that the President truly believes that almost everything the federal government does is needed. Indeed, subsequent terminations, reductions, and savings released with the President's annual budget proposals in 2000 and 2011 have offered a similarly insignificant but detailed offering of spending cuts. It would be interesting to know whether some cuts recommended by OMB staff were shot down by the White House. Was it communicated internally to OMB staff that they should only look for savings that would be the least likely to ruffle the feathers of special interests? If that's the case, then the president's suggested savings were nothing more than a political prop designed to fool the American people into believing that his administration was serious about reducing federal spending. Or was OMB given the green light by the White House to truly go program by program, line by line? In that case, OMB itself could be responsible for producing the insignificant cuts. I spent 2 years as a deputy director at the state of Indiana's Office of Management and Budget under Governor Mitch Daniels. If the circumstances at the federal OMB are similar to that which I experienced as a state budget official, then it's quite possible that the White House chose to ignore OMB's suggestions for more substantive budget cuts. I was part of a dedicated team within Indiana's Office of Management and Budget called Government Efficiency and Financial Planning. The group was tasked with conducting a long overdue inventory of the state's operations. We produced two reports with hundreds of recommendations for making state government more efficient and effective, and we also made recommendations to cut or eliminate programs and boards. Unfortunately, the governor did not follow through and execute very many of the recommendations. I also suspect his political advisors also dissuaded him from ordering action. In fact, the advisors were so worried about the potential political fallout from aggrieved special interests over the recommendations contained in the second GEF report that it was intentionally released when the media wasn't paying attention. They needn't have worried because those interests who might have had cause for concern already saw that the first report was barely acted upon. The governor's advisors typically sided with turf protecting department heads, and they did little to support GEFP. The reason was simple. The perceived political cost of pursuing our recommendations usually exceeded the perceived political benefit. I learned from my Indiana government experience under a governor thought to be a fiscal hawk that political leaders are good at generating sound bites designed to make taxpayers believe that their interests come first. In reality, taxpayer interests usually end up taking a backseat to the interests of select individuals or groups. I also learned that a failure to back up sound bites with a follow-through action only serves to embolden special interests. Cato has publicly challenged the president on his pledge to go through our federal budget page by page, line by line, eliminating those programs we don't need. Attached to my written testimony is a copy of a full-page ad that Cato ran in major newspapers. We suggested 10 areas to target for cutting that would result in substantial savings, and the suggestions were arrived at based on Cato's own page by page, line by line review. You can see the results of our review at www.downsizinggovernment.org. We posted essays laying out the case for terminating hundreds of agencies and programs, and it's worth noting that we've been able to cover all that budgetary terrain through the efforts of a very limited number of people. Lastly, it's important to note that the administration's inability or unwillingness to recognize that more than just 0.5% of the federal budget is unneeded is not a partisan affliction. President Obama inherited a federal budget that had massively expanded under the previous Republican administration of George W. Bush. The massive welfare state built by Republicans and Democrats is morally bankrupt, and if the federal government were a business, it would be financially bankrupt. That means that the federal budget's meat has to be cut in addition to the fat. Therefore, if President Obama isn't serious about terminating unneeded federal programs, then it's up to Congress to do the job for him. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Patrick Lewis Knutson. I'm the Grover M. Herman Senior Fellow in Federal Budgetary Affairs at the Heritage Foundation. I should mention, in the interest of full disclosure, that until just recently, I was the policy director at the House Budget Committee here, a position I held for 20 years. My remarks should not be construed as expressing any official position of the Heritage Foundation. That said, I'd like to take a slightly different angle on this subject and attempt to put it in context, a context that all the committee members are aware of, because this discussion about terminations and reductions and so on comes in the midst of a budget that is really wildly out of control, as Chairman Stearns mentioned earlier. If I may recite a few facts that I'm certain all of you are familiar with, but they bear repeating. Fiscal year 2011 was the third consecutive year with a budget deficit in excess of $1 trillion. Debt held by the public is about three-fourths the size of the entire economy right now and growing. It can't be said often enough that three entitlement programs, Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security, are in the process of swallowing up the entire budget. All three are growing more rapidly than the economy, more rapidly than inflation, and those of you who wish to protect these programs need to be aware of that, because they cannot be sustained at that level. They'll collapse of their own weight. By 2050, those three programs alone will absorb all the tax revenue the government collects if historical patterns hold. That means you will be borrowing every year for such other interesting activities as defending the country. Now, the in this vein, the administration's discretionary terminations and reductions amount to less than 2% of the cap in the Budget Control Act. They're barely more than 1% of the projected deficit for 2012, and they're only about 0.5% of projected total spending in 2012. All of that is just context setting, and I say that not to dismiss the discussion that's going on here today or the practice of submitting terminations and reductions and so on, but simply to recognize that this is the bare minimum of what administrations and Congresses need to be looking at. You should be able to adopt these kinds of proposals on an annual basis just as a starting point to get this fiscal situation under control, because the things I just described represent a crisis. I believe there's no exaggeration in saying that. Now, that said, there are a number of tools that the President and Congress do already have and could use to get spending under control. The President does have a veto. President Bush was criticized for not using vetoes of spending bills often enough, and that criticism may have been fair. It could be leveled at President Obama as well. As far as I know, he has vetoed one appropriations bill, and that was because it didn't spend enough. Congress also can apply spending caps, and right now you are facing a cap in the Budget Control Act. I would urge you most strenuously to stick with it and, if possible, reduce spending even below that level. Because remember, the savings you're talking about under that cap are savings from a baseline that inflates every year. So they're really just savings from an illusion of projected spending. Excuse me. Other items you could look at are unauthorized appropriations. Every year, the Congressional Budget Office submits a report of appropriations that have lost their authorizations or whose authorizations are to expire by the end of that fiscal year. This year's report identified $42 billion worth of non-defense programs whose authorizations were to run out on September 30th. To my knowledge, all those programs have still been financed in the continuing resolution. You could easily make a rule that any program that loses its authorization does not get funded anymore, and then you would have to justify restoring the program. That, it seems to me, is a more valuable approach than having to justify cutting a program. There are other recommendations in my written testimony that I would invite you to look at. What I would conclude by saying is, from time to time in my years at the Budget Committee, I would hear members complain that they spent all their time on the budget. I have two responses, and if you did the things I'm recommending, you would be spending even more time on the budget. But I have two responses to that complaint. The first is, if you believe, as I do, that budgeting truly is governing, then budgeting is an exercise of your fundamental responsibilities, and I would think you'd relish the opportunity. Second, and far more important, considering the very real spending and debt crisis this country faces, I would hope every one of you and every one of your colleagues in the House and Senate would spend every minute of your time on the budget until you get it under control, because the stakes are very real, and the future of the country may very well be in your hands. Thank you.
Right? Can you hear me? Yep. Chairman Stern, Ranking Member DeJette, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to testify today about President's promise to review the federal budget line by line and eliminate program we don't need. My name is Véronique de Rugy. I'm a senior research fellow at the Mercatus Center at George Mason University, where I study tax and budget issues. The goal to conduct an exhaustive review of the federal budget and seek to eliminate wasteful spending is not only worthy of presidential and congressional attention, it should actually be your highest priority, and taxpayers, too. It's hard to overestimate the harm caused by the current congressional spending pattern and the economic damage caused by the misallocation of capital and the creation of perverse incentives. However, While the idea of putting an end to wasteful spending makes for great speeches and interesting headlines, waste as defined by the president is only a small portion of the overall wasted taxpayers' dollars. Depending on your point of view, concepts like waste or even inefficient spending mean something different to each member of Congress, each taxpayer, and the president. Today, I would like to go over guiding principles that I recommend be used to produce an effective review of government spending. There are four. First, Congress and the president should eliminate overt waste, the low-hanging fruit, so to speak, such as duplicative program and overpayment. Taxpayers are currently paying for 47 job training programs, and according to the GAO, it spends $125 billion in improper payment. Second, Congress and the president should eliminate spending for programs that don't measure the performance of the program they manage. Take the Small Business Administration, for instance. It only measures its performance by measuring how much it spends to guarantee loans. Instead, it should measure whether these loans are actually growing the economy. If it did, it would realize that this program isn't as relevant as one thinks, and that it isn't even fulfilling its stated mission. Third, Congress and the President should eliminate spending for programs that should be provided by the private sector. Having the government run businesses such as Amtrak and oversee infrastructure such as the air traffic control system is not just inefficient. It also hinders economic growth and costs taxpayers money while providing low-quality services to customer. Fourth, Congress and the President should eliminate spending on functions in the purview of the states. President Reagan wrote that federalism is rooted in the knowledge that our political liberties are best assured by limiting the size and scope of the national government. Sadly, Congress has ignored this advice and is now spending $500 billion in grants to the states for activity that it has no legal or practical reason to be involved in, such as healthy marriage promotion and museum professional training grants. This is inefficient, and it creates an acceptable lack of accountability. What's more, when lawmakers are busy running state and local and private affairs, they have less time to oversee federal agency and focus on critical national issues such as defense or security. Applying these principles is a necessary condition to conduct an effective line-by-line review of the federal budget that would get rid of the wasteful spending that plagues our government and our economy. Make no mistake, there is absolutely no excuse for government and the president to allow such large amounts of wasteful spending to continue year after year. This is exceptionally shocking considering that numerous programs have already been identified as wasteful, inefficient, or duplicative by Congress, OMB, and the GAO, as well as scholars at think tanks and university. Their work should help facilitate congressional oversight of the effectiveness of government program and operation. Yet, they are being ignored. So obviously, there are a lot of questions still unanswered about how to enforce this principle and how to actually achieve real budget cut. I mean, I don't really know what this budget process is if in the end, programs that have been identified as wasteful are still getting money and are being funded. Understanding that there are certain things that only the federal government can do and that there are things that the federal government shouldn't do will guide the review process and help make hard decisions about where to cut spending. I have one final thing to add. It is key that all spending be on the table. Congress needs to make sure that no area of the budget are untouchable. No, not entitlement, not defense. All part of the budget must be on the table for review and potential cut. With this guiding principle in mind, Congress and the President will be able to start making the difficult spending priority that they need to make, and the American people will start having confidence in their future and confidence in the way that the federal government spends its money. Thank you for the opportunity to testify before you today, and I'm looking forward to your questions.
Acting Chairman Bill Bray and Ranking Member DeGette, members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to testify on behalf of the American taxpayer regarding the important issue of reviewing the federal budget to identify waste. My name is Andrew Moylan, and I am Vice President of Government Affairs for the National Taxpayers Union, a nonpartisan citizen group founded in 1969 to work for lower taxes and smaller government at all levels. NTU is America's oldest nonprofit grassroots taxpayer organization. We have over 362,000 members nationwide, in every single state, most of the territories as well, including several dozen in the Virgin Islands. I like to sort of lighten the mood and start with an old joke that our budget tells us what we can't afford, but it sure doesn't keep us from buying it. Unfortunately, that has been true of Washington for far too long. Our current budget situation is bleak, and I want to point to two nuggets that I think are instructive. First, in the President's recent budget outline, the lowest single-year deficit in the coming decade is $607 billion, a number higher in absolute terms than every annual deficit in our nation's first 220 years, and roughly equal in inflation-adjusted terms to our overspending in war-mobilized 1944. Additionally, while many in Congress have attributed the recent explosion in spending and resulting trillion-dollar deficits to crisis response due to a financial meltdown and a recession, the federal government has actually seen deficits during 45 of the last 50 years. And we believe that this ought to give pause even to diehard Keynesians who believe that surpluses should be the norm in most economic growth cycles. President Obama has repeatedly pledged to scour the budget line by line to eliminate waste, inefficiency, and duplication. He and Senator McCain both made such a claim in a 2008 presidential debate, after which we joined with our friends at Citizens Against Government Waste to send a letter to the candidates offering our existing research and our ongoing assistance in completing that task. Unfortunately, the tidal wave of red ink in our future suggests that a tremendous amount of work still remains. I want to give credit where it is due, however, and refer to a few areas in which the President has truly been a leader. First, the issue of billions of dollars in improper payments made by federal agencies. From a 2009 executive order to the 2010 signing of the Improper Payments Elimination and Recovery Act, a bill that NTU strongly supported, the President has been a consistent and effective advocate. In addition, his administration's recent efforts to reinvigorate whistleblower protections will help to protect federal employees that identify waste and fraud from professional retribution. We hope Congress will follow that lead by moving swiftly to pass the Bipartisan Whistleblower Protection Enhancement Act. While these efforts are laudable, there are still tremendous gaps that call into question the President's pledge. For example, the administration's most recent termination reductions in savings report, which has been mentioned several times, laid out $33 billion in suggestions to trim our deficit and was its most ambitious such effort to date, but still it represents just 2 cents out of every dollar that we currently borrow and less than 1 cent of every dollar that we spend. Surely a comprehensive line-by-line review of the federal budget did not determine that it operates at 99% efficiency. A more specific complaint is that the President has not yet crafted a comprehensive replacement for the Bush administration's program assessment rating tool. While it was imperfect, with complaints that its structure did not yield objective results, PART was actually a good start at evaluating program performance and deserved to be improved and expanded upon, not ended. In order to further the debate on wasteful spending, we joined with the U.S. Public Interest Research Group to author a report called Toward Common Ground, Bridging the Political Divide with Deficit Reduction Recommendations for the Supercommittee. In it, we identified over 50 specific recommendations, totaling more than $1 trillion over the next decade for spending reductions. While we disagree with PERG on a great many issues, we are united in the belief that we spend far too much money on issues on programs that do not deliver results for taxpayers. For example, we're spending billions of dollars on things like export promotions for profitable corporations, excess spare parts orders for defense equipment, and maintenance costs for thousands of unused or underutilized federal buildings. Many of these items have been on budget watchdog lists for years, and the opposition to these recommendations tends not to be primarily political or ideological in nature, but rather parochial. Some highlights of the joint findings with U.S. PERG include $215 billion in savings from eliminating wasteful subsidies, $445 billion from ending low-priority or unnecessary military programs, $222 billion in savings from improving program execution and government operations, and $132 billion from common-sense reforms to entitlement programs. We believe that the NTU PERG report demonstrates that reducing wasteful spending is not a question of right or left. It's a question of right or wrong. And we stand ready to assist this committee, the Congress as a whole, and the President in the quest for a sustainable budget future. And I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Coleman. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Stearns, Ranking Member DeGette, and members of the committee, subcommittee, I thank you for inviting me to testify today on behalf of the U.S. Public Interest Research Group, U.S. PERG. U.S. PIRG, the Federation of State PIRGs, is a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that advocates and educates on matters to encourage a fair, sustainable economy, promote the public health, and foster responsive democratic government. As a congressional supercommittee begins its search for $1.2 trillion in deficit reduction, my organization was proud to partner with NTU, as Andrew had mentioned, to offer a set of recommendations to this committee and the bipartisan panel of more than $1 trillion over 10 years of spending cuts and government reforms with appeal from across the political spectrum. How government collects and spends money is critically important. Tax and budgeting decisions are the most concrete way that government declares its public priorities and balances between competing values. Unfortunately, budget-making rules and public laws about taxes and spending sometimes fail the public interest. U.S. PIRG advocates for improvements in fiscal policy to stop special interest giveaways, increase budget transparency and accountability, eliminate waste, and ensure that subsidies and tax breaks serve the public. Public money should be spent for the most effective pursuit of clear public benefits or to encourage beneficial behaviors undervalued by the market. Budgeting should be open, accountable, and follow long-term planning. Our September 2011 report with National Taxpayers Union Toward Common Ground details the specific spending cuts, and a copy of the report has been included in our written testimony submitted for the record. NTU and PIRG, as Andrew had mentioned, do not often agree on policy approaches to solving our nation's problems. On recent high-profile debates around health care reform and oversight of the financial markets, the two groups proposed and advocated very different solutions. Even on a number of tax and budget issues, we often disagree. Here, we successfully identified federal programs that both Republican and Democratic lawmakers should recognize as wasteful and inefficient uses of taxpayer dollars. In calling for this hearing, the committee asked about, quote, identification of characteristics of federal programs suggestive of waste, fraud, and abuse. U.S. PIRG's approach to spending cuts is guided by four principles. We cite these principles as an appropriate lens through which deficit reductions can be judged. One, oppose subsidies that provide incentives to companies that do harm to the public interest or do more harm than good. An example here is funding for biomass research and development. Large-scale agricultural production of corn and other crops used for biomass can accelerate problems caused by deforestation and compete with food production, raising prices globally. Two, oppose subsidies to mature, profitable industries that don't need the incentive. These companies would engage in activity regardless of the taxpayer support. We would include in this category subsidies for dairy management, which, among other things, pays pizza chains to make and market extra cheesy pizza. Companies like Domino's have both the incentive and the resources to develop their own products to meet consumer tastes without taxpayer handouts. Support three, we would support reforms to make government more efficient. And here, examples include requiring the Department of Defense and the Veterans Administration to jointly purchase prescription drugs, saving more than $6 billion over 10 years. And finally, four, oppose subsidies where there is authoritative consensus to do so. By this, we mean strong independent agreement across the political spectrum and that a program is wasteful, or the agency or department itself receiving the funding has argued against it. Within Secretary Gates' recommended cuts, he included the expeditionary fighting vehicle. The Secretary of the Navy and the Commandant of the Marine Corps both agreed with the Defense Secretary's proposal. These recommendations are specific, targeted, and name individual programs for reductions and elimination. We are long past the time for general references and rhetorical calls for attacking nameless and faceless programs that contain, quote, waste, fraud, and abuse. This is a precise reason that U.S. And PIRG does not support across
Mr. Coleman, I need you to summarize, if you could.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're just going to say that the precise reason we don't support across-the-board cuts is just that they don't differentiate between genuine waste and inefficiencies in the system. We believe that there are good programs. They need to be separated out from the waste that we identified in the report.
And I thank the gentleman. Mr. Collender, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My testimony today is my own personal view on the subject of the hearing. My comments absolutely are mine and mine alone. A few very brief words of personal introduction. I'm generally thought of as a deficit hawk. I get criticized from both the far right for being too left and by the left for being far too right. I actually take a great deal of comfort in this. I'm pleased that when it comes to the federal budget, I'm considered a centrist and rational. My budget background is also decidedly bipartisan. I proudly work for three Democratic members of the House of Representatives and the Democratic staffs of the House and Senate Budget Committees when I was much younger. But I was also the first speaker at the first meeting of the House Tea Party Caucus held on February 28th of this year. I spoke to the Tea Party Caucus at the invitation of Congresswoman Bachman, who liked a column on the debt ceiling I had written for Roll Call in January. She asked that I discuss it in depth with the House members and the other Tea Party supporters who attended the meeting. It was a privilege for me to be able to do so. My background is important because I want what I'm about to say about this hearing to be understood in the bipartisan centrist context I'm often criticized for having. Based on everything I've studied, observed, participated in, and commented on about the federal budget over the past almost four decades, it's hard for me to understand why this subcommittee is spending any time and wasting so many taxpayer dollars holding this hearing. The answer to the question on which this hearing supposedly is based is as straightforward as they come. Of course, the Obama administration has done and continues to do a line item, but line by line, program by program review of the budget. There's simply no reason for the subcommittee to think otherwise. A line-by-line review is standard when every White House puts its budget together, but it's especially the case in a year like this when spending cuts are the main course on the federal budget menu. Here again, the reason is straightforward. Unless you're using a meat axe and eliminating whole departments and agencies, budget cuts require additional detailed line-item reviews beyond those that routinely happen when the President's budget is being formulated. These additional reviews typically include the senior White House staff, the Cabinet, and the President and Vice President. The inevitable policy choices and political decisions involved with those cuts cannot be made at lower levels. There are three extraordinary ironies about today's hearing. The first is that none of the witnesses, including me, have any firsthand knowledge of whether or how the Obama administration conducted the line-by-line review about which the committee says it's so concerned. That immediately raises a serious question about why any of us was asked to testify. Second, never mind the White House. Congress is the branch of the U.S. government that seldom, if ever, does the line-by-line review of the federal budget this committee seems so desperate to have done. That makes a hearing on congressional line-item review procedures far more justified than one like this on what the White House is doing. Third, final irony, is that one of the primary reasons most representatives, senators, and congressional committees don't review every line item is because the White House provides Congress with voluminous, painstakingly detailed materials that are based on the in-depth line item reviews it conducts when it formulates the President's budget. Mr. Chairman, there's a good deal more I could say about this subject, and I'll be happy to try to answer your questions. But honestly, I really don't see any reason to waste any more taxpayer dollars by prolonging a hearing that never needed to be held in the first place. Thank you.
Thanks, gentlemen. Mr. Lilly, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. I thought I had a strong statement, Mr. Chairman. But I'd like to...
I need you to put your mic on.
I'd like to pick up where Stan left off and say I do think there's a good side to this hearing because I think line-by-line budgeting is extraordinarily important. It's not the best way to do a budget. It's the only way to do a budget. And I think it's slipping from our grasp for a number of reasons I'd like to talk about. First of all, is the administration doing line by line? I have to agree with Stan. I find a lot of the conversation this morning remarkably silly on that regard. Every April, every budget officer of every agency sits down with every section chief and goes through item by item of what was spent in the past year, what is needed in the coming year, what they could afford, how they could reduce their spending, how they could cut back on services, what would be the impact of a 10, 20, 30% cut. That happens all across the board. It produces amounts of budget material that I think this committee can only imagine. Ranking Member DeGette pointed to the appendix of the budget. In that appendix, and there it is, there is probably half a page that talks about the United States Park Service. I have materials that the Park Service submitted to the Congress this year. This is a reprint of it, 583 pages on the Park Service. If you want to go into whether this is detailed or not, this is an item on the Kennesaw Mountain National Park. Cobb County, Georgia, has bought and provided the Wallace House to that foundation. and they are including $157,000 in two full-time equivalent positions in order to staff that. That is a lot more than line by line. That is the detail that gets into everything that every employee of this government does. And so the idea that that's not happening is ridiculous. Do you like the decisions that were made? Well, maybe you do, maybe you don't. One big cut that this administration made that nobody's mentioned was the termination of the F-22, which I didn't agree with, but it was a huge, huge cut. Now, the other thing I would say is I think there's been a real deterioration in line-to-line budgeting. The executive branch bears part of the burden for that. We have reams of needless, stupid data that is included in budget materials every year on a formulaic basis. It deprives our resources to get in a dig into the budget in a real way, and it ought to be eliminated. We have been relying, because of the executive branch, year after year on huge supplementals. Veronica has written eloquently about that. That has been at least slowed down in this administration. It's been a big step forward. But frankly, what puzzles me about this hearing is it's a lot like the umpire stopping the game and going out and chastising the pitcher for not calling balls and strikes. The framers of the Constitution did not charge the executive branch with being a check and balance on excessive spending in the executive branch. That's why you guys are here. That's the purpose of the Congress. And that's where the line-by-line budget review has to take place. If you don't do it, nobody will do it. Before 1921, from the first Congress in 1789 until 1991, the executive branch played no role in putting the budget together. Every agency went directly to the Appropriations Committee and asked for funds. So we don't even need the executive branch to be in here. It's your job to put the budget together. Now, I think that has been seriously deteriorating in my period of time here. And there are three things that have happened, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to get. First of all, we have deliberately destroyed expertise. The limitation on subcommittee chairmanships meant that a guy like Ralph Regula, who knew as much about parks and forests as any member of Congress, had to move from the Interior Subcommittee to the Labor H Subcommittee, where he had never served a day, just deliberately destroying the expertise necessary to do this process. The second is the earmark orgy that we went through over the last decade. From 1995 until 2005, we had a quadrupling of earmarking. We had as many as 15,000 requests for earmarks go to the Labor H Subcommittee, which is the biggest domestic appropriations subcommittee. Do you know how much staff time it takes to do that? It completely eviscerated the ability of that subcommittee and every other subcommittee to do the kind of oversight and line-by-line review that is necessary. Right. Now, we've finally gotten rid of that, and I'm very thankful, and there are people on both sides of the aisle that worked to get rid of it. What did we do with all the time and the resources that we gained by getting rid of that? We went on vacation. Look at the calendar that the majority leader posted this year. In January, the House was in session 6 full days. In February, we had 2 weeks off. In March, which is the height of the season for testifying by agency witnesses on their budgets, we were in 8 days. We had the first ever St. Patrick's Day recess. The same thing is true of April, May, and June when the
Mr. Lilly, I just need you to sum up.
Yeah, I think you're the silliness right now.
Okay, let's just have you sum up. You're a minute and a quarter over.
I would just simply say this. Line-by-line budgeting is hard work. It's the work of the Congress. The Congress has to be here to do it. It has to organize the resources. It needs to be tough with the executive branch in demanding the information that's necessary. But that's not been happening for more than a decade.
Thank you, and I thank the gentleman.
Mr. Chairman, I would respectfully ask that the members of this committee at least be civil to the witnesses who have been given up their day to come here.
And I think I agree with you. Now that we have finished with our opening statements, I'll start with my line of questioning. I would point out to Mr. Collender and Mr. Lilly, I agree with you, Congress should also do a line-by-line, and I think your points are well taken that Congress has a fiduciary responsibility and has had historically to do that. We have a letter that we received from the Office of Management and Budget, and one of the things we were concerned about is that when the President comes up with initiatives that are savings, we never know how much money this is saving. For example, you have securing American values and efficiency. They talked about the President's SAVE Act, that his award is going to save all this money. But we're not clear how much money it's saving. So it's hard sometimes for us and members of Congress to hear the President say he's going to create all these savings line by line, whether you agree with the President should do it or Congress. But when the President says it, and he says line by line, item by item, program by program, page by page, and then we try to understand where these savings are, it's difficult for us to find them. So the hearing today is to try and have a better understanding. Now, Mr. Schatz, your office has actually, with your staff, has developed a database, and you've actually gone in to do this, as I understand it. And so it's possible for the Citizens Against Government Waste to do this, and you certainly think Congress could do it as well as the President's Office of Management Budget. Wouldn't you agree?
Well, since I am under oath, Mr. Chairman, we didn't do it exactly line by line.
Okay.
But we did use the resources that exist in the public and private sector and consolidated them into our list of prime cuts. So it's Congressional Budget Office, it's the Congress itself, it's the President's budget, recommendations that go through GAO or Inspectors General, and just put together a comprehensive list, 691 recommendations. I'm sorry, the recommendation to save $691 billion, I'm sorry, over 1 year and $1.8 trillion over 5 years. So the information is there. A lot of these recommendations have been around for many years. Our origin, as I mentioned, goes back to the Grace Commission under President Reagan. So those recommendations were incorporated into the President's budget. And our major point has been if there is going to be an initiative, there should be a way to find out what's happened with that, so that the taxpayers can say, this was proposed, this is what happened. And in a sense, it doesn't matter what it's called, it just needs to be presented in a way that these questions shouldn't be asked. We're having a hearing because we don't have the answers, not because there shouldn't be a comment about whether it's line by line or not or what it means. It's just there have been ideas in the past that have been proposed where someone can go and see what's been done, what's been saved, and what's being proposed the next year.
Well, I know when the Republicans first took over with the Contract with America, we had a long list pretty much that we developed from many of you in the audience, in the witnesses today, that we tried to use to reduce spending. And the methodology that you use or your criteria for your program evaluation, could you just briefly tell us what that was?
Well, at least within what we looked at in the prime cuts, it was looking at the resources that had already reviewed a lot of these recommendations, for example, the Congressional Budget Office or our own evaluation, and certainly looking back at how these recommendations had been made, we've used some of the similar criteria that NTU and U.S. PIRG have used. If a program is going to be proposed and funded by the federal government, there should be a way to determine whether that program is achieving its goals, and if it's not, it should be eliminated. And that's, in a sense, the simplest way to do it. Another way is to look at whether the government should be involved at all, the old Yellow Pages test under President Reagan that he used to speak about, and whether the government should even be, quote unquote, in a business or in a situation that allows them to compete with the private sector. So there, in some ways, it depends on which area of spending we're looking at.
Regardless of what everybody says here, based upon the video we just did was your interpretation that he was going to go page by page, item by item, line by item? Was that your interpretation of what the President said?
Yes, but okay. Again, through the process that is supposed to occur, the better question is what happened after that
what
comment?
Happened, and where are those savings? Right. Let's talk about transparency for a moment. Is the federal government required to establish a single searchable website to track federal procurement?
It is now under the Federal Accountability and Transparency Act, after it occurs, yes.
When was this website launched, and how effective is this site in providing transparency to the more than $1 trillion in federal contracts? Do you have any idea?
It is usaspending.gov, and it was proposed originally by then-Senator Obama and Senator Coburn. It passed both houses, was signed into law. It does have useful information. Interestingly, I received an email the other day from a gentleman who looked through it and just put in the word coffee and found, you know, hundreds and hundreds of expenditures on coffee. So there is a way to search it. It is useful, but it's after the fact. It's spending that has already gone out the door, as opposed to looking at the spending before it occurs, and that to us is more important.
I guess a question would be, is if the administration is actually, are they using the information at usaspending.gov to complete its line-by-line review? I don't know.
I can't answer that.
Does anyone on the panel know if the has any hint if the the president is actually using that site at all? No.
I do know that they have been very focused on contracts as area of potential savings, reducing the contracts, cutting the margins on contracts. And so that site is one way to find out what's going on there, and I know that that's being factored into there.
So. All right. My time has expired, and recognize the gentlelady from Colorado.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Knudsen, up until very recently, you were the policy director at the House Budget Committee, correct?
Yes.
When did you leave that position?
In August.
August of this year, so very recently.
Yes.
And so, as you know, what happens in the budget process, the administration develops a budget. Mr. Lilly said they get all kinds of data through the different agencies. They come up with their budget. They send that to the House of Representatives, correct?
They send it to all of Congress.
Right. And then the House and Senate budget committees go through that. They come with... In a good year, they come up with their own budget. They pass that budget. Then they do the 13 appropriations bills, correct?
I believe it's now 12, but yes,
okay.
That's the process.
The 12 appropriations bills, those bills actually appropriate the money from the budget, and Congress has the discretion about whether or not they're going to fund those programs, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Then that goes to the White House, and then the president decides whether he's going to sign or veto those bills, right?
Yes.
Now, in recent years, what's happened, and I actually think it's unfortunate, and I think the chairman will probably agree with me on this, we've sort of devolved over the last number of years to doing a big omnibus appropriations bill. And as a result, members of Congress don't have the ability to vote on those separate 12 bills, correct? They just vote on the omnibus, whatever it is.
That's right, yes.
And the president doesn't have an opportunity to veto bills either because they spend too much or too little for each of those 12 areas of government, right? It's like an up or down on the omnibus, right?
That's correct. Although, as you know, in the Constitution, he may provide a list of his objections. And
right, but he doesn't have line item veto authority. That's one of the
things
we've argued about over the years. So thank you very much for illuminating that for me, because the point I'd like to make, Mr. Chair, I thought about asking all the witnesses whether they talked to the president to see if he, in fact, did a line-by-line review. And I thought about asking all these witnesses, what does a line-by-line review mean? Does it mean the agency look at it or whatever? And then I realized that's really aside from the point. Seems to me the point of this hearing was to bring a whole bunch of people in to testify as to their political beliefs about what the president should or shouldn't be doing. But the bottom line is, right here in Congress is where the rubber hits the road. Right here in Congress is where we can do a line-by-line review of the budget, either figuratively or literally, and decide where programs should be cut. The only useful testimony that I have heard, with all due respect, this whole day is the testimony by Mr. Moylan and Mr. Kalman, who came together from opposite ends of the political spectrum and actually made serious recommendations as to places that we could cut. And so, Mr. Chairman, what I intend to do after this hearing is get their report and look at it, and then I think I might forward it on to the Budget Committee, not the Energy and Commerce Committee, which is where we develop the budget in Congress. With that, I'm happy to yield back the balance of my time.
All right. Next person is Mr. Griffin, is from Virginia, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do note with some interest the whole debate that is taking place today in regard to the line-by-line item. and whether or not the president, you know, can in fact go line by line or whether he should go line by line. And all of that's very interesting to me. What I think is more important with that line of questioning is that this was a promise that the president made, and it does not appear, if I understood some of the testimony correct, that he has actually done that. Was that my understanding of your testimony, that based on your analysis, Mr. Moylan, that you don't believe the president actually has followed through or his people followed through on a line-by-line analysis?
Well, I think the president and his administration have done a tremendous amount of work to analyze the budget line-by-line. I think the question is really what the result of that has been. And the result of that, from our perspective, has not been enough in terms of tackling wasteful spending. But if I might take this time to respond, at least in part, to what Mr. Goetz said, I would actually largely agree that the president plays an important role in this process, but it is a limited one. And this is part of the reason, for example, why NTU has for years supported something of an anti-appropriations committee, to have a standing committee in Congress that has as its job to do a consistent line-by-line review of the federal budget to look for savings, as opposed to what the Appropriations Committee does. So I think that there is a lot of work that can be done in concert there to help improve these processes.
In that regard, have you all taken a look at the House rules, in particular Rule 21 in that area, to determine whether a change in the House rules might change things, that the way things business is done in the House Appropriations and Budget Committees?
Sure. We have for years analyzed many different suggestions to change the rules of the House in order to put in more incentives to tackle wasteful spending, to give Congress more tools to do so. Some of the concepts that we've talked about earlier, things like biennial budgeting as well, have been things that we've been supportive of because we think that would bring more accountability to the process.
Because my frustration, quite frankly, to the entire panel, but particularly Mr. Moylan, is coming out of the state legislature in Virginia, where I served for a number of years, there the budget controls, and if we don't have the money to do something, the budget doesn't spend the money. I have learned here, at least what I've been told, is that if we have a law on the books as a result of these rules, we have to fund that whether we have the money or not, which is where we get into the whole debate about mandatory versus discretionary spending. Do you think that we as a Congress need to change the psychology where we maybe take a look at the way that Virginia does, where if we don't have the money, we don't spend it, and the budget controls, as opposed to the law controlling the budget controls the laws?
That's actually been the subject of considerable debate in recent years, is the not just the fact that dollars that are considered mandatory spending are growing in large part because of entitlement programs like Medicare and Medicaid, but how many other programs are now mandatory that are their funding is more formula-based rather than a discretionary action by Congress. So, yes, I do think that there is much work that can be done there to appropriately distinguish between what mandatory spending is and what discretionary spending ought to be and what ought to fall in which category.
Because notwithstanding Mr. Green's discussion of his legislative experience and a senior legislator saying that, you know, by the third year he only read his own bills, I've always tried to read the bills, and both my state experience and here, and I have discovered some things in there that I would like to work on, some of which I've been told I can't yet because it comes up later in the mandatory, because it's mandatory, it's in a five-year bill, et cetera, and that's been somewhat frustrating. And there are things like that. I discovered a 1970 law that says that when we take horses off federal lands, we can't humanely euthanize them. And as a result of that, we have what I call retirement homes for wild horses and burros at the tune of about $70 million a year. And so when I'm looking for line by line, when I'm actually reading the budget bill, and I'm not going to tell you, as was pointed out, that every reference and cross-reference that I am familiar with at this point, I hope to be sometime if I'm allowed to stay in the Congress for a few years. But when I'm looking at these things, those are the kind of things that I think a line by line analysis would find and would then, you know, if I were, and I don't plan to run, but if I were president, that I would say, hey, let's change that 1971 law and straighten that out, because it just doesn't make sense when we don't have the money to be spending money on that when we have citizens who may need that money for other purposes. That being said, Mr. Chairman, I yield back my time.
I would say to the gentleman from Virginia, if you offer a bill to eliminate that $70 million for the Social Security for horses, is that what it is? The retirement home. Okay. Well, you might drop that bill, and I'd be happy to be one of the co-sponsors.
All right. I'll see if we can get that drafted up, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Thank you. Do you recognize anyone on the Democrat side? If not, we'll go back. We go to the gentlelady from Tennessee. Ms. Blackburn is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to each of you for being with us today. Mr. DeHaven, you were the Deputy Director of the Indiana Office of OMB, right?
A Deputy Director.
Yeah, okay. And did you ever do a line-by-line review for your state?
No, I would not say we did a line-by-line. We actually went program by program. We actually conducted, when Mitch Daniels was the head of OMB, he came up with the PART system. When he became governor, he directed, created the State of Office of Management Budget in Indiana and had them come up with PROBE and basically do the same thing. We met with programs, we went through, met with program heads, we went through the programs, on and on and on, and that was the result, was these reports we came up. In addition to those reports, we came up with these performance measures. And I do note with interest, I hear talk about PART and I hear talk about performance measures. I actually implemented performance measures out in Indiana. That was my job. They were political. The numbers we got back were often BS, excuse me. And the whole purpose of the performance measurement system for Governor Daniels was to put out these temporary press reports and show the Indiana taxpayer that, look, we're getting better, we're going from red to green, I'm a better steward of the taxpayer dollar. As I put in my testimony, all the decisions were made when it came to cutting programs or government efficiency or all that other stuff boiled down to politics and special interests.
Okay, let me ask you this. Did you all ever do what Governor Christie did in New Jersey with across-the-board cuts? He did a 9% cut. My state of Tennessee former governor did significant cuts like that. Did you all ever do any kind of across-the-board cut to help get the spending under control?
When I was there, we did not do across-the-board cuts. I left right after the recession started to hit and state revenues dried up. Since then, I do believe that there was suggestions made for across-the-board cuts. The governor can also withhold money a lot easier in Indiana.
All righty. I know that Mr. Orszag did a memo that I have with me where he recommends a 5% across-the-board cut and stated, and I'm quoting, to reach the 5% target, your agency should identify entire programs or sub-programs, or, number two, substantial cuts amounting to at least 50% of total spending within a program or a sub-program. The intent of this exercise is to identify those programs with the lowest impact on your agency's mission, end quote. And I think what I want to do, I know Mr. Coleman is against across-the-board cuts, but I would like to start with Mr. Schatz at the end and work down. Are you, how many of you favor across-the-board cuts? Every, you know, this is something I favor, 1, 2, or 5% across-the-board, just to trim the fat, if you will, and help agencies focus their attention on what needs to be reduced. So let's go down the line and let me see who all favors an across-the-board cut.
I would say yes, but I also know that you had proposed many of these amendments over the years, and when you talk about a penny on the dollar or 2 cents on the dollar or 5 cents on the dollar, your amendments were consistently defeated in the prior Congresses. So it's not the first thing that should be done, because waste is identifiable and should easily be eliminated. But it certainly points out that in any other organization, if you need to balance your books because you can't keep spending money or borrowing it, it's something that could be done. But again, it wouldn't be the first thing I would do.
Okay. Mr. Day?
No, we need a deeper philosophical discussion about the fundamental role of government. When you had the budget agreement for 2011, I actually noted that a lot of the cuts ballyhooed by Speaker Boehner were similar cuts that Newt Gingrich engineered. The fact of the matter is, if you cut the head off the hydra and you don't burn the stump, it grows back. So you get your 5% on board, even if you're going to get it. So long as they exist, they'll grow back.
Okay, we've got 44 seconds left, so quickly down the list.
The disadvantage is that obviously across-the-board cuts don't choose priorities and so on, but they have the same advantage that a spending cap does, and that is they impose a limit, and the limit can compel choices.
Okay.
I believe that there's easily 10% waste in each department, each program. However, again, I think it's not our priority because it doesn't allow to differentiate between,
okay,
between programs.
I would say that NTU's view is that it's a second-best solution, but it's one that, as you know, we've consistently supported those amendments because we believe spending reductions are necessary.
Very quickly, because obviously I said we have issue with cross-board cuts. And just to be very specific about it, there's a couple of programs, for example, that have received bipartisan support, such as Pell Grants. And so cutting Pell Grants in the face of when there is massive waste that NTU and PERG found, we find that troubling. And so okay, we prefer a closer look at the budget.
Okay.
I'd rather you make decisions based on priorities as opposed to an across-the-board kind of meet-ax approach.
Okay.
I think there are programs that are overfunded. There are programs that are underfunded. Across-the-board cut is the antithesis of line-by-line, which is what this hearing's about and which I think we need to dedicate ourselves to.
Okay. Yell back, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentlelady and the gentleman from Texas. Mr. Green's recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And for my colleague who I heard earlier that he mentioned he read all the bills, congratulations. you're in your first term. like I said, I'm hoping to read the bills in my subcommittees on energy and commerce. In today's hearing, the majority is focused on the Obama administration's budget process and directed substantial criticism toward the administration. But ensuring a sound and efficient budget process should be a goal that doesn't break down on partisan lines. In fact, a number of the witnesses for us today have expressed concerns about the budgeting process that spans administrations and political parties. For example, Mr. DeHaven and Dr. Gerizzi, in one article you both co-authored, you said, and I'll quote, "The fact that we're having a mounting deficit because George W. Bush is the most gratuitous big spender to occupy the White House since Jimmy Carter. One could say that he's become the mother of all big spenders." Can I take this from you that both agree that the Bush administration created a lot of the debt problem we now confront?
Yes.
It's an undeniable fact.
Okay. Both for each of you, Vice President Cheney was quoted by his Treasury Secretary saying, Reagan proved that deficits don't matter. Do you think Vice President Cheney was wrong?
Yes, absolutely.
Hmm. Yeah, they matter. I mean,
okay.
I mean, there could be a debate, an academic debate, right? Until recently, academics, you know, could not find a correlation, still haven't found a correlation between the size of deficits and interest rates and things that matters. However, I mean, there's been, we don't know, so there's this side of the debate, right? And then, however, we know that there's a point where deficits are so big and the size of government is so big and the size of the debt is so big that the tumor becomes so big that it starts destroying everything. And then there's a principal issue, which is, in theory, the amount of taxes that are
collected. I only have 3 minutes, so yeah, I have a whole bunch of questions, but you know, do you agree that,
yes,
you know, deficits,
yes,
where we're at now?
You guys shouldn't be spending more money than you tax.
Come in the last 10 years. Because I'll remind y'all that in 99 and 2000, we had a balanced budget, for an annual balanced budget.
Well, not if you if you had planned reasonably and put money aside to pay for all the unfunded liability and a promise made.
Oh,
no, it's
well,
not a balanced budget.
Granted, but we officially, not counting Social Security.
Yeah,
that's
officially.
But officially, we were actually buying down our national debt in 99 and 2000.
Officially, but budget, okay, gimmicks is what, okay, Congress has used to actually make something,
well,
look black.
And
when
those
really
are
red.
Bipartisan gimmicks, but let me go on.
Yes.
Dr. Ruggie, in one of your papers on an off-budget emergency spending, you document how most of the 8 years of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan were paid for with money that was not part of the congressional budget limits. That was literally hundreds of billions of dollars. As you point out in the paper, emergency spending is supposed to be used when the need is unexpected and unpredictable, like,
yes,
hurricanes or something like that, that we had a debate over the last month. Question, when the president proposed this misuse of offline emergency spending year after year, which president proposed this misuse of offline emergency spending year after year and long after they were expected and predictable?
President Bush.
Okay. It was complacent with Congress.
Absolutely.
Obviously, on in both parties in control.
Absolutely. And so, Congress was happy to let the budget rules that was supposed to restrict some of that abuse expire.
In one of your papers, you also called the Bush administration profligate, and which, coming from Texas, we don't hear that very often. But and did you say that in the paper, that the President Bush administration was prolific?
In spending?
Yeah. In spending, of course.
I'm French. Just in case you didn't notice. Okay.
Doctor, which president proposed to Congress that it stop using the off-budget emergency spending from which you've been so critical?
Oh, I mean, the president, President Obama, has accepted, you know, there's no evidence that the abuse is not going to be continued.
Okay.
There's no rules that actually are on the book now to actually prevent it. And if the debate over the latest round of emergency spending is any indication, there's no one in Congress who's actually really serious about reconsidering the abuse of that loophole.
So this is both a congressional and presidential problem that we have.
Yes.
Dr. DeHaven, in the past you've written about agriculture subsidies and is, quote, the orgy of supplemental spending bills that have increased the spending. Would you tell Congress that agriculture spending is part of that low-hanging fruit for deficit reduction?
I would consider it to be so, especially when you have record incomes. But then we saw that back in 1996. Congress comes up with freedom to farm because incomes are high, and they said, we're going to weed you off, and we're going to give you temporary payments to do that. Farm income prices promptly drop the next few years. They come up with emergency supplementals, and then they go 2002 under the Bush administration, Republican Congress. They take the temporary payments and make it a permanent handout. So,
Mr. Chairman, I don't think I can. I have any more time, but I appreciate the answers to the questions.
Thank the gentleman. And the gentleman from California, Mr. Bilbray, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I think there is an item we might be able to agree on here, and there might be a real opportunity to really get a focus on where both sides can cooperate on this. Let me first pull out, Mr. Lilly, you remember the comments about the earmarks in 95. Do you also remember that the first initiation was that we had an administration that were taking line items and moving them from one line item to another to basically get around cuts? And so there was a lot of that originally was to lock things in so the administration couldn't shuffle funds. And, you know, and also you do remember that a thing called an earmark was the predator, which is probably the most cost-effective and efficient weapon systems ever developed in this country since the monitor went out to Hampton's Roads and confronted the CS Virginia. Those two items, in all fairness, you know, I'm saying when it started off, there was a major reason why there was a concern there.
I think if you look at my written testimony, I make the point that the Predator was, if it's not in the testimony I submitted today, I've often referred to this. I don't think that earmarks are evil as such, but I think the practice where we went on the Labor H appropriation bill, we had zero earmarks in 1995. We had about 40 in 96. We had over $1 billion in earmarking by 2004.
And I think what's the sad part about it,
completely overwhelmed the system.
Though we didn't get the education out that the real abuse was a thing called the airdrop, where people were dropping things in conference where no one had the right to be able to extract it and get into it. As the person who had to inherit the seat of a certain congressman who abused that. Let me go over and ask U.S. PERG. U.S. PERG today, I enjoy listening to your testimony about so-called renewable fuels and the abuses in the system, because I remember in 95, when I came here, you had the Lung Association, U.S. PERG, strongly pushing the oxygen mandate, strongly pushing as an environmental and health issue the requirement that ethanol be put in our gasoline, MTBE and ethanol. And I appreciate the fact that U.S. PERG has reassessed not only the lack of health and environmental benefits, but also the cost on this.
I was not around in U.S. PERG in the 90s, excuse me, to the extent, so I'm unfamiliar with our previous position on ethanol, but it's in the report. We believe that it is no, you know, it doesn't serve the purpose and it's a wasteful.
Not all items that people think, even the so-called experts think, great for the environment and the health, turn out to be what is projected. And so I'm real touchy about it, guys, because I had ads run against me that I wanted children to die because I oppose that. And I opposed it because my scientists in California knew that it was a problem back. Let's go to something we can't agree on. Mr. Knutson, your idea about if it's not authorized, we should not be spending money about that.
Yes.
Now, that's something that I think Republicans and Democrats, and comes back to your point about Congress now taking the responsibility and starting to take the reins back. Can you go down the list? Each one of the people here, would you encourage us to demand that Congress take a look at that and make that a policy?
Yes.
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 Yeah. I'd have to look. I have to look more closely at it.
Yes, but it's not required by the Constitution.
I know. There's a.
Let me just say.
Neither is a balanced budget, but we'll.
We've had not only a collapse of the budget process and the appropriations process, but the big collapse has been the authorization process. If you look at CBO's report to the Congress from last January, over half of the non-defense appropriations were for things that weren't authorized. Some of them haven't been authorized for 20 years. Now, most people don't want to see those programs ended. But unless the authorizers are able to reactivate this process and review those programs, then I think you're kind of stuck with appropriating money without authorization, and it's a terrible thing.
You believe that we shouldn't force the issue and require the authorizers to do their job and reauthorize?
We should, but I don't think people that depend on those programs should suffer as the result of the failure of the authorizing committees to do their work.
And so you think that future generations should suffer by us continuing to spend 43% more than we have money for?
That's different from cutting spending. I'm not saying we shouldn't cut spending. I'm saying that's a very arbitrary way that's going to hurt a lot of people that you're probably going to find out you didn't want to hurt.
Okay, Democrats, Republicans work together and authorize a 2-year budget cycle for the veterans. Do you believe that we should look at applying the same application for the rest of the budget or large portions of it down the line?
I think that would be, if the Congress wants to maintain control of the budget, that's a bad thing for them to do.
I agree with Scott. It'll reduce responsibility, not increase it.
Again, we'd have to look at it more carefully.
Yep.
I'd say it has to be done with care, but yes, it should
Next.
Be considered.
No.
No.
You got a bunch of more supplemental spending. Indiana had one, and that's no.
Yes.
Okay. My argument is if we did that, maybe we'd have time to start doing authorizations and be able to get our job done the other way, but that's the disagreement. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank
I think,
gentleman.
Though, we found an agreement of something, hopefully the Democrats and Republicans on this committee can take to the other committees and say, here's a common ground that we have found on this committee, and that's why this hearing needed to be held. Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask you? Brian, I've had this discussion for, I think, I'm going into 2 decades about the difference between ethanol and MTB.
Well, I'd okay. love to explain to you the difference, but the outcome is still the same. It picks our pocket and it pollutes our air.
Ethanol they make up in the Midwest.
Oh, that's for another hearing. The gentleman from Louisiana, Mr. Scalise, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know that there were some people who said they didn't think we should be having this hearing. I want to thank you for calling the hearing because I think as we have more hearings like this, I think it does put more pressure and put more sunshine on the fact that we really do need to be doing more on all fronts to not only find waste in government, but also to hold people accountable for the things they say. I've been kind of amused by or intrigued by the comments from some of my colleagues. You know, when the president actually said these words, we will go through our federal budget page by page, line by line, eliminating those programs we don't need and insisting that those we do operate in a cost-effective way. I'm kind of shocked that some of my colleagues on the other side are now claiming that when the president said this, he really didn't mean it. I'd be curious to know what other things the president has said that he doesn't mean.
The gentleman yield.
I'd be happy to yield.
I don't think anybody said that the president didn't mean it. What
we wanted to know. The ranking member said.
I'm the ranking member. Hi.
The ranking member of the full committee.
And I said.
Mr. Waxman said.
And Mr. Waxman said that we didn't know if the president actually read it line by line or not, but the OMB did. So don't put words in
my mouth. Well, but he said that he didn't mean it literally. He just. You know, I guess he just says things and whether he means them or not. But if he said it and he meant it, and, you know, I'd love to have the OMB here. And as the chairman pointed out, we wanted to have the OMB here. They refused to come. We could ask them if, you know, because obviously they must have had those conversations with the president and his staff of, you know, whether or not they were directed to go line by line through the budget. But
I think from seeing some of the things that we've seen, clearly that hasn't happened. You know, and of course we have had the president come before our House chamber and say, you know, with this latest stimulus bill, saying pass this bill, and we found out there wasn't even a bill. He didn't even have a bill to pass, yet he's saying pass the bill. So maybe he does say things he doesn't mean, but he ought to mean what he says. And I think the American people deserve to hold him to the things he says. And I think that's the bigger issue, is that if he is going to say these things, he ought to expect to be held accountable for those things he's saying. And that means as we try to go line by line through the budget, I think if you look at what we did in the House, we actually passed a budget, something novel, something that hasn't happened for years. Senate, it's almost been 900 days since the Senate passed any budget. We passed a budget, and our budget was actually geared at getting us back on the path to a balanced budget. Our budget was $6.7 trillion less than the president's budget. And so we did, in fact, go line by line and found many areas of things that the government is doing that it can't afford to do. We're borrowing money we don't have. We got to stop spending money we don't have. And we started to make that fiscally responsible decision that we were going to get our country back on the path to a balanced budget so we can create jobs and get the economy back on track. And in fact, our budget got more votes in the Senate than the president's own budget. The president's budget was brought up in the Senate. Not one member of the Senate voted for the president's budget. Not one Democrat, not one Republican. Nobody. You would think if the president was serious about going line by line, and he saw such an embarrassment that not one United States senator voted for his budget, maybe he ought to go back to the table. Maybe he ought to start over and write a different budget that maybe included ideas from both sides that showed some effort at bipartisanship instead of a budget that people neither side of the aisle chose to vote for. And so it brings us to some questions, because if you look at some of the things we have been going line by line in this committee is the committee that exposed the Solyndra scandal. And in fact, when we tried to go line by line and get more details, we actually had to get a subpoena because the administration wasn't even giving us the information. And so, unfortunately, by the time we got the information, went line by line per se, we didn't have the ability to stop that from happening. The taxpayers lost $530 million. You know, if the president would have just gone line by line with the memos that were written by his own staffers, who said the day, you know, 2 days before he went to Solyndra for a photo op, they said, frankly, you shouldn't be going down there, and this thing's probably going to go bust. I mean, the taxpayers are going to lose hundreds of millions of dollars. But instead, they wanted the photo op. You know, so maybe he went line by line and said, you know what, I still want to go have the photo op anyway. But the taxpayers lost out, and we tried to go line by line here in the House, and we were denied. They stonewalled us, and we had to subpoena the records. Unfortunately, we finally got them. Unfortunately, the taxpayers are already on the hook. So the Heritage Foundation, I know, is here. President's talked a lot about Medicare and, you know, saying he's going to go root out waste, fraud, and abuse in Medicare. And it's something we've all encouraged to do. We all ought to be rooting out waste, fraud, and abuse in Medicare. But has even that happened, where they've gone line by line and gotten those hundreds of billions of savings that we've all heard about that he was going to go and find there?
I can't say what really has happened inside the administration. What I would say, waste, fraud, and abuse is always something you want to cut out, just as these items the president has proposed. They should not be dismissed. They ought to be considered seriously and disposed of in some way. But when it comes to Medicare, the problem is much more fundamental than waste or overpayments or any of those things. The Medicare system is collapsing, and unless there's some fundamental restructuring of it to change the incentives in the way it works, the system can't stand up, or it will swallow up increasing amounts of the budget in the economy and take.
And the president's own actuaries, President Obama's handpicked actuaries, confirmed that Medicare goes bankrupt in 12 years if we don't do anything. So those folks sit and say do nothing. Basically, they say let Medicare go bankrupt, and that's not acceptable. So
yes,
I appreciate that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. We're going to go a second round. At least I'm going to do a second round of brief, so any member would like to is welcome to stay. This is an extraordinary hearing in the sense that we have these fiscally responsible groups, so many of you, in one room, and it's rare. I've been in Congress, this is my 23rd year, that I've ever seen this collection of reputable organizations who are really sole mission is to try and protect the United States from a bankruptcy, or at least to try and have a responsible budget. And so I think it's kudos to all of you for one, your interest and pervasive attempt to control spending and to give insight to Congress. I know many of us, before we vote, will ask, you know, whether the Citizen Against Government Waste, the National Taxpayers Union, the Heritage, will ask, at least on this side, will ask to say, what is your view? So I think it's important that all of you realize that you are important to us, and that's why I think it's important to have all of you here. I want to ask Mr. Moylan, the National Taxpayers Union, I have in your opening statement, you talk about this termination reduction and savings plan that the Office of Management and Budget issued, and they total about $33 billion in savings for 2012. And I guess when you look at that at a $3.8 trillion, that's less than 1%. And yet that's the expenses that the President and the OMB is offering, and it's so minimal. So the question all of us ask, well, where are the other savings in light of the fact that we have this huge budget deficit yearly and this huge debt growing? We borrow 41 cents of every dollar pay for the budget. And so these figures are staggering, yet to think that there's only $33 billion is the only level of cuts. Am I missing something? That just seems very austere and very minimal.
Well, I think your sense of it is very similar to ours, in that when we review a report like that and see what is ultimately a relatively small number, and I would also point out that many of the specific recommendations that the OMB made in the terminations report are actually not just spending side. There are also tax provisions in there that would have the effect of raising revenue. So it's not all just spending cuts, but you know, this indicates to us that there's a tremendous amount more work that can be done in terms of tackling waste and inefficiency, and we think that, you know, we're offering ourselves up as a resource in our work. And, you know, there's a lot of sort of partisan rancor in Washington about a lot of things, but there's actually a fair amount of agreement in the watchdog community about where the waste exists in the federal budget. We think that our report with PERG demonstrates that. And we hope to take that message not just to the President but to Congress as well.
Let me ask a few of the others. Mr. DeHaven, $33 billion, it seems so minimum. Now, you're saying that's not complete because there's tax increases, so there might be more savings that have been balanced out because of the tax increases?
To clarify, it's $33 billion in deficit reduction. Some of that is extra revenue, and some of that is spending reduction.
Okay. All right. Just a comment, Mr. DeHaven, what you think about that kind of, I think with the Cato Institute, that seems pretty minimal to you, too, doesn't it?
Well, it's paltry and insignificant, but I also want to point out, and I left this out of my spoken testimony, that, you know, this stuff about waste, fraud, and abuse. Waste, fraud, and abuse in government programs will, like Christ said, that the poor will always be with us. Waste, fraud, and abuse will always be with us. And the only way to get rid of waste, fraud, and abuse in a government program is to make that government program disagree. Now, whether it's Republicans or Democrats, they all fall back on this waste, fraud, and abuse stuff, and we need to be having a more fundamental discussion about the role of government and a deeper ideological discussion about where we're going to go and what the federal government should and should not be doing.
One of the things that I think many of us felt that government programs should sunset, and then before they're reinstituted, that there should be an oversight hearing to determine whether that program was effective. Would all of you agree with that, that we should take government programs and sunset them?
Yes, I would.
Yes. Mr. Haven?
I don't have a problem with some sort of process by which we have these discussions. The problem is, and I was going to bring in the budget appendix up there. It's, and I didn't bring it in because I don't have the arm strength these days.
Yeah.
It's massive. And so when it comes to oversight, when you have a government that big, when it comes to authorization and stuff like that, it's very hard for even a master of the budget to know what all's in there, let alone a member of Congress, let alone Joe or Jane Lunchbucket out there who actually has a real life out of sight of Washington, D.C. And it's just too big and overbearing, and somehow you have to cut that down to make more sense of it. Otherwise, we're going to continue to have these discussions year in and year out.
Okay, just quickly, go ahead.
Yes, I would support that idea.
Mr. Wright.
I agree with Ted DeHaven, but sunsetting is a good first step.
Yeah.
We've long supported sunsetting as a way to inject some more accountability into the process.
Mr. Kalman?
We would not support that. We think there's programs that have wide support and are widely agreed, and, you know, Pell Grants, as I said before, is one of them.
But then how would you get oversight of these programs without the threat of termination? I mean, you wouldn't get any oversight. These things go on indefinitely. But anyway, I appreciate your opinion. Mr. Cullen?
Sure, but it's not the panacea you think it is. Okay. Most programs will just be continued anyway.
Because of the politics.
Of course.
Yeah. Mr. Lilly?
I think the reason we have 20 committees in Congress is so that we have the capacity to do the oversight. The problem is those committees are not doing the oversight. I'll give you one example. I did a report last year on a government contractor that is charging 80% gross margins. The product that contractor produces was developed by the United States government. The facilities that they use to manufacture it were paid for by the United States government, and we're paying 80% for it, and that contractor is getting paid under authority from this committee. Now, why aren't you having a hearing on that rather than this? And you got to get down in the weeds.
Let me ask you, can you name that contract?
Emergent Biotechnology.
Emergent?
Report on it here.
Well, if you don't mind, I'd like to put that part of the record. Without objection?
No objection.
No objection. We're glad to put that part of the record, and I think there's probably more programs like that out there, Mr. Lilly. And
I'm
so
convinced there are.
If you find any more, please let us know. And you're saying that's the jurisdiction of the Energy and Commerce Committee.
That's correct.
That we should view. Well, I've finished my second round. Is anyone else on the Democrat side? No? Ms. Griffin, you're recognized.
Just a couple of matters, Mr. Chairman. Thank you so much for the time. I appreciate your courtesies. First, let me just say, y'all might want to go back, those who did not agree with the biennial budget, and just take a look at some of the models that those hotbeds of ideas in the various republics, the states of this union, are coming up with. My experience was that as long as you have some ability to amend so that you can correct the errors that you might have made the first time around, that the biennial budget makes for a smoother process. The battles philosophically over what gets spent are not quite as pitched in some circumstances when you have that biennial budget the second time around, and people seem to try to work with it. That's just my take on that. In regard to sunsetting, shows you I'm new around here. I thought that's what reauthorization was, that if you ran out of authorization, that was a sunset. But I would have to say, in relationship to those comments, if the program is worthy and somebody gets hurt accidentally, Congress will start to scramble quickly to reauthorize a program. I think reauthorization is very important because it is the tool by which a sunset is enforced. And if you don't have to worry about reauthorizing, then why put it in there in the first place? Just authorize it permanently and be done with it. In regard to the comments by Dr. Ruge and Mr. DeHaven, you were asked some questions about the spending of the Bush administration, and you gave your very frank and honest opinion. I'm wondering if you're seeing a major change in that spending growth under the current administration. If each of you could answer that, I'd appreciate it.
No, I don't. In fact, I often say that President Obama is President Bush on steroids.
Mr. DeHaven?
I've made that same comment, but we're both, you know, we're still in Iraq and Afghanistan. We're still spending money on everything that Bush spent money on, maybe just more. I barely see the difference some days.
I appreciate that and agree with you all that, we've got to take a look at at somebody who said, I don't want to attribute to everybody by using the colloquial you all, but the person who said that we've got to take a look at the role of government, which is why when I'm reading bills and taking a look at these things, a lot of times I'm scratching my head wondering why the government got into this in the first place. Even though they may be very good programs, I've seen quite a few of those. If you all can help us figure out where they are, and I do look forward to looking to the report that the two groups, both left and right, did, that's the kind of thing that's very helpful to us. I think there are a lot of things that we, as Americans, both Democrats and Republicans, left and right, can agree on. I have found this hearing today to be very helpful and educational. I appreciate you all taking your time. And, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate you calling the hearing. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman, and just remind all members, we have 10 days to hold the record open for any additional comments or opening statements. And, again, I want to thank all of the witnesses today for your time and willingness to help us out. And with that, the subcommittee is adjourned.